Hi folks, this is Jay, and hope everybody's okay. We've got the builders in. They're doing some work on the floor in the house, and also the weather forecast is going to be pretty bad. So I'm going to do a Google Hangout, and it's basically I'm just going to read my notes and share stuff about my study notes that I made on the resurrection of Christ. So I want to do that today, and basically this Google Hangout will last a couple of hours. And basically what I hope to do is, if you're a Christian, to give you some resources, some research material that can help you in defending your faith on the resurrection. To point you in the right direction to various books, to various websites, to share my own studies and research that I did, and to look at various apologists that you can look at that will be a help to you. And if you're a skeptic, many of you have probably seen my old videos and will know much of what I'm going to be talking about. But it'll be an opportunity for you to think about some of the things concerning the Christian faith if you're interested in that. So without further ado, let's come before the Lord. It's good to be with you, and thank you for coming and listening. Some exciting news for those who like good preaching. Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones Recording Trust, you can copy the lectures and sermons of Lloyd-Jones. So I'll also be doing that in the next few days, because I'm excited that we can use his material, because I think he's a wonderful preacher. So let's come before the Lord. Lord, we thank you for today, for your love and your grace and your care, and we give you the praise and the glory today. We thank you that you are our Saviour, you are our Lord. And Father, we pray in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, and for your glory, we praise you, Lord, and worship you today. And we pray, Father, that you be in this video. I pray that it would have a wide influence, and that, Lord, it would be an encouragement and a help. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, Amen. Amen. So, what we're going to do, if you can see behind me, you can see all my research notes there that I did. I studied those notes. It's over a year or a year and a half's worth of study on the resurrection. And so I'm going to point you to some books, then we're going to look at the notes. Okay? And I'll point you to some books on the internet. So hopefully we can get a few books for you. All right? So we're going to have a good time. There's going to be a lot of stuff that you can learn about. And the stuff for you. Okay, we've got pointing you here now. If we go to screen share, okay. Here's a book that is a must if you're gonna defend the resurrection. You need to read this book, or at least familiarize yourself with Dr. Borkum's research. It's very, very helpful. We'll be looking at in detail on Dr. Borkum and his studies and what he researched. So that'll be good. So that's Jesus and the Eyewitnesses. That will give you some background material on why the Gospels are reliable. Will help you in your seminary or college, or wherever you are at work, to be able to share some ideas and thoughts of why you believe in Jesus. I don't agree with everything of Richard Borkum, but he's really helpful. Okay, for some reason, I don't know why, but anyhow, I don't know why, but anyhow, we're gonna just I'll just look at some books and scholars that historical Jesus studies and stuff like that. Okay, if you're going to study about the historical Jesus, E.P. Sanders is perhaps one of the most leading scholars in that area. So you need to at least know about E.P. Sanders and read about E.P. Sanders, because he's a major player in the academic world concerning the historical Jesus studies. So you really need to at least familiarize yourself with this scholar. I would say he's the foundation stone for historical Jesus studies. Okay. He's not evangelical. He doesn't believe in inerrancy. Doesn't believe things we believe as evangelicals. So I'm not endorsing his theology. But he's a building block to defend your faith, because a lot of the skeptics will question the source material that you might use to defend your faith. And when you start to read these kind of scholars, you'll find that the skeptics are behind the times, that they're not actually up to speed on the scholarship. So you need to a little familiarization with these kind of scholars will give you a lot of help, either in debates with skeptics or in your own Christian faith, and talking to people about Jesus and the resurrection. Okay, so that's a must. Perhaps one of the leading scholars on historical Christ studies and the resurrection is Tom Wright, or N.T. Wright. This is more of a look at the Gospels, but he's written some massive tomes. I had to study one of them at seminary. We had a semester on one of his books, massive big tome of a book. I think that N.T. Wright is a massive scholar. You can't ignore him. So if you're going to read about historical Jesus studies and the resurrection, you need to read N.T. Wright. Is an amazing guy. I don't agree with everything. I don't agree with him using Israel as a hermeneutic to understand everything in the Gospels all the time. It works to some extent, but I think he takes it too far. I'm not so sure he's an inerrantist, and so there are other stuff that I'm not happy with, but he's got a lot of scholarship behind him, and he deserves the respect, because if you go on his website, you'll find thousands of bits of material to study on the historical Jesus. So He's a must. Howard Marshall is another top-notch scholar, more conservative. This is I Believe in the Historical Jesus. Howard Marshall has written some massive, massive commentaries, and he's a big scholar. And you need to be reading people like that on the historical Jesus studies and on the resurrection of Christ. I'm not saying I agree with everything Howard Marshall. I'm a conservative evangelical, but certainly really good top class scholar. All right. I Believe in the Resurrection by George Eldon Ladd is a great, great book. He's a top-notch scholar, and he goes into all the main issues about faith and history, how history and faith relate to each other. Awesome guy. Absolutely awesome. So I love this book. It's a very, very good book, very helpful. If you're going to debate people on the resurrection of Christ, if you're at a college or university, very, very good book indeed. All right. Another top-notch scholar is James D.G. Dunn. This is one of his books. Another book that he's written is Jesus Remember. Now, I don't agree with James Dunn. I don't. In some ways, like I said, I'm a conservative evangelical scholar. But you can't do historical Jesus studies and ignore someone like James G. Dunn. He's such a giant scholar. So if you're getting serious and you want to study as an apologist, you need to be reading material like this. If you are a Christian and you want to get deeper, you need to be willing to listen to these people lecture or study these people. I'm an evangelical, conservative evangelical. I'm not anti-intellectual. All right? These guys are not inerrantists. They don't believe the full inspiration like we do. But you got to find out what they're saying so that you can answer them. So I'd encourage people to always read widely, and I think I've engaged with reading and looking at James Dunn a little bit, and I'd encourage you to do that. So, atheist scholar, this is on the verge of both, but one of the leading scholars on the resurrection from an atheist perspective is Gerd Ludemann. So have a look at Gerd Ludemann from a skeptical point of view. He's a very interesting scholar. This is on the Virgin Birth, but you can find other stuff by Gerd Ludemann. Like I said, read widely. Read the skeptics as well as the conservative evangelical. In historical Jesus studies, there are different camps, different ideas of who Jesus is. And then all these different ideas you can, they'll have different views about the resurrection. One scholar, Gerd Thiessen, he's a well-known scholar. The Shadow of the Galilean is an interesting book. Like I said, I don't agree with this scholar. Some of the, a number of the scholars I don't agree with. All right, but I'm just telling you about them that they're important scholars. And he's an important player in the historical Jesus studies, okay? We're going to be talking about other scholars. Now, a book that is very helpful on a popular level is this book. This is The Gospel Truth, Answering New Atheist Gospels Attacks, Paul Barnett. Okay. Very, very good book. Interversity Press. And it'll give you some tips, some of the standard arguments that atheists use and what they say. Give you some tips of how to deal with the questions that people have to put. Okay, this is a must read for any Christian doing evangelism to atheist. All right, it's a must read. Really, really will help you. I've debated and discussed with a number of atheists, and I find this book as a good preparation for those discussions. Okay, this book, Oxford University Press, Who Chose the Gospel? C.E. Hill. It is a scholarly work on the Gospels, and that's a must. If you want to be encouraged in your faith, but really deep, it's deep. Basically, it goes into Irenaeus, an early church father, and why he's significant in why we believe the Gospels. And it's a really good defense against all these ideas about Da Vinci Code, but it's a heavy read. It's an academic work, and it's very, very helpful. On a more popular level, but excellent book. This is an excellent book by Lee Strobel, The Case for Christ. This is really, really, really good. I mean, forget if you don't read anything. I mean, forget these things. This is what you need to read. This is a superb book. If you're going to read a number of those are heavy duty academic books, some of them. Okay. That's when you get really into the historical Jesus studies, when you really get into it all, and resurrection of Christ studies. Most of them are academic. This is a popular work, but you get these academics in a popular way, and it's superb, absolutely superb. It's one of the best books you could ever read on who Jesus is and the resurrection. Top book. You've got Bruce Metzer, you've got Blomberg, you've got all the great scholars in there, evangelical. Very, very good book. Give your family a copy, buy a copy, give your family a copy. Excellent, excellent. Okay. A couple of more books. This book. Yeah, you see it? The Quest for the Historical Jesus by Schweizer. That tells you the history of historical Jesus studies. You look at Strauss, Bohr, Renan, excellent book. More for students and apologists, but when you're debating people, discussing people, having a background to the history of historical Jesus studies is very, very helpful. It gives you an edge against your opponents. So you need to read the history of the quest for the historical Jesus. And then the creme de la creme. This book, Lycona's The Resurrection of Jesus, and published by Apollos. Oops, sorry. Very, very brilliant book, because what he does is he takes secular ideas of doing history and he implements it in historical Jesus studies and the resurrection. I've heard skeptics, not this book, saying that people don't, academics in the academic world don't rate this book and whatever. But well, that's just nonsense. I mean, if you look at the back of the book, Gerd Thiessen, Paul L. Meyer, Gerd Thiessen. It is fascinating to follow Lycona's argument step by step in his investigation of the resurrection of Jesus as a unique event in history. This is a necessary book, and I recommend it to all who are interested in interpreting the Bible and the Christian man in a Christian manner. Paul L. Meyer, no episode in the life of anyone in history is more important than the resurrection of Jesus Christ. I warmly commend this book to all who want to know if the resurrection of Jesus is really happened. And then C. Ben McCullough in The Logic of History, author of Logic of History. This is an astonishing achievement and a major contribution to the ongoing debate. It is clearly written and full of fresh insights and arguments that will enrich discussion for years to come. So basically, what I've just read you some of the top scholars in the world who endorse the book. Top scholars in historical Jesus studies and history. All right? So when the skeptics attack this book and say it's not taken seriously, they're just telling you a pack of liars. Okay, that's some of the books on the market. There's also some works by Gary Habermas, which are very helpful and important. The Case for the Resurrection of Jesus by Gary H. Habermas and Michael R. Lycona is a good book that you could get, okay? Excuse me. So those are just some of the works. If you go onto N.T. Wright's website, just type in N.T. Wright, you'll get, there's two websites, an official one, an unofficial one. The unofficial one has got more material on. But you'll find articles there about the quest for the historical Jesus up to date, which take the story on from Schweizer. All right? So I'll just check in here first. Sorry about this. Just sent a message to a friend of mine, Mark. Mark, how you doing, mate? Oh, you doing, bro? Love you, bro. Hope everything's okay. I'm just staying in today because we got bad weather. I was preaching in town. I did 4 hours preaching, so I'm pretty knackered, mate. Anyhow, we got the builders in doing the floor, putting in a new floor, and then we've got it's going to rain soon, so I'm in the house, so I'm going to go through these. So those are stuff, books that are important. Okay. Okay, so what we're going to do now is, now I'm going to get all these notes. Okay. That's what we're going to do. We're just going to look at all these notes that I have. Okay, all these notes. All these notes is a year's worth of research on the resurrection, mainly. A lot of debates that I've listened to and articles that I've read as well. So basically, we're just going to look at my notes on the resurrection and just talk about the scholarship, about how to defend the faith concerning the resurrection of Jesus, really. So this will be a help to pastors, preachers, those involved in youth work, those involved in theology, those involved in apologetics, those who are students at college, university. I'm going to look at a stack of my notes. I'm going to look at many different scholars, many different thinkers, what they said, and so it's a year's worth of research that I'm going to be just sharing with you. And that's what I'm going to be doing. You probably heard a number of the bits of what I'm going to share. Let's stay with it because it'll be helpful. Okay. So here we are. So we've got our Bible. So that's what we're going to do. For research, those who want to do research on the historical Jesus, a good place to go is Fordham University, Fordham University. Okay, you go on Fordham University. What you will find is they have a website of ancient documents going right back to the Persians, right through to the Roman Empire. And it has all these ancient documents. And if you're interested in defending the faith, either as a pastor or as an apologist, it's a very, very good website, because I think what's important when you're defending the faith, or when you're reading anything, is not just to read the books, but to do your own research, to go and read the ancient documents yourself. As a Christian, don't just listen to Bart Ehrman, or an atheist, don't just listen to Bart Ehrman or Dominic Crossan or N.T. Wright or your favorite scholar or whoever. Go and do your own research. Go and do think it through yourself by looking at the ancient documents yourself. Too often, students and scholars, students, apologists, pastors might read N.T. Wright or might read Dominic Crossan and get their ideas. That's just popular scholarship, in the sense they're not popular scholars. I mean, they're top scholars, there's no doubt about it. But what you're doing is you're engaged in popular scholarship. If you're just reading N.T. Wright or reading Dominic Crossan or reading any of these big time scholars, but you don't go and do your own research, you're just going to parrot what they say. You can see that with presuppositional apologists. Presuppositional apologists will learn what Van Til or what these Christian apologists have said, and then everybody just repeats what they're saying. But you've got to do your own thinking, you've got to do your own research. Okay? One of the places where you can do your own research is Fordham University. They have a big list of ancient documents, and it's awesome. It really is awesome resource. And I go on it, and I have a program where I want to read through many of those ancient documents. So that's important, okay? I got some notes here on the Gospel of Luke, which we'll go into, but it's important. It's important in historical Jesus studies, if you're going to defend the resurrection, to read the Gospels. The Gospels are an important source, and we're going to go into detail why that is. But when was the last time you read a Gospel? When was the last time you studied a Gospel? As skeptics, when was the last time you read a Gospel? Just simple. You say you don't believe in the Christianity. Well, when was the last time you actually read one of the Gospels? Okay? Now, in my studies of the resurrection of Jesus, I studied a lot of debates that by atheists and non-Christians as well. So there'll be a lot of those debates that I've looked at coming out as well. Okay. Put that there. Seeing this is Evidence. It's important if you're debating people to have clear definitions of what the criteria is. And also if you're going to talk to people on the ground and you're going to have a discussion with people about did Jesus rise from the grave, etc. Definitions of words that you're using, criteria that you're using, if you're clear on that, you're going to be ahead of the game in the discussion with people. All right. So I have a list of words that I have pieces of paper on that help me to make sure that when I'm using words, I'm clear about them. So evidence is a noun, the available body of facts or information indicating whether a belief or proposition is true or valid. The study finds little evidence of overt discrimination. Also, law, information drawn from personal testimony, a document or material object used to establish facts in legal investigation, or admissible as testimony in law of court. Without evidence, they can't bring a charge. Next, signs or indications of something there was no obvious evidence of breaking. Verb, with object B, or show evidence of the quality of the bracelet as evidenced by the workshop workmanship is exceptional. Phrase, call someone in evidence. Law, summon someone as a witness. Give evidence. Law, give information and answer questions formally and in a person in the law court. Or at an inquiry, the person concerned may refuse to give evidence. In evidence, notable, conspicuous, his dramatic flair is still much in evidence. Origin of the English word, via Old French from Latin, evidentia, from evident, obvious to the eyes or mind. So it's important, like, if you're going to debate people, or even if you're doing evangelism, and you use words, and someone says, well, give me the evidence. Or you say to them, give me the evidence. What do you mean by evidence? You've got to be clear on the kind of words that you use. In the discussion with people on the resurrection concerning concerning did Jesus rise from the dead and the historical Jesus, one of the things that people will say is, well, it's obviously developed over time, the life of Jesus, because in the Gospels, in the Gospel of John, it's very, very high Christology. That is, it's like talking about the divinity of Christ. And the other Gospels, it's low Christology. It's not talking about divinity of Christ. So obviously there was some kind of change. There was some kind of development going on and an invention of who Jesus is. This is a sort of misnomer. I mean, there's, first of all, high Christology, low Christology is not something that's been what Jews understood in first century Judaism. So you've got to be wary when these people start using this language. You need to call them out and say, well, if we're looking at an ancient text, let's look at the ancient text. Don't bring your hermeneutical tools to try and shape the text. High Christology, low Christology, that ain't in first century Judaism. But once you've called them out on that, this is apologist I'm on about, not ordinary people. The next thing you need to do is to show them that there is high Christology in the Gospels. For example, in Matthew, in the Sermon on the Mount, in Matthew 5 and 6, the Lord is saying, you know, you heard it in the Torah, now I say. You know, for him to do that, he's taking full authority that he's the Word of God above the Torah. Now, for a Jew, that would be blasphemy. So that's high Christology. He's saying he's God when he's saying that. When he says, you've heard it once said, now I say. God might have said it in the past, but now I say. That's high Christology. In Mark, early on in Mark, the Lord forgives a sinner before he actually heals him. That's high Christology. All right? So there's high Christology in the Synoptic Gospels. Okay, yeah. Get to some more. Got some notes here on Richard Swinburne. Why Hume and Kant were mistaken in rejecting natural theology, Richard Swinburne. I claim that the arguments both philosophers about the limits to human understanding and knowledge are totally unsound. He writes, now given any earlier point, it does not follow that even if the concept of cause is a concept of regular succession, it cannot be meaningfully applied to regular succession of, I think, an un, can't read those words, sorry. Hume was, I've just, my notes are a bit sketchy sometimes. Hume was, however, I suggest, mistaken in supposing that our impressions of regular succession, or even much impressions from which we derive our idea of causation, for we experience ourselves causing effects. A basic action or action which an agent does intentionally but does not do by doing anything else intentionally. He writes, without the general principle, who I call the principle of credulity, that is the problem that things are as they seem to be, we could have no knowledge of the basic world. Richard Swinburne is a scholar. I don't, he's a philosopher, and he's a very interesting philosopher. I don't agree with him on some basic things. I'm again, conservative evangelical, and he's very all over the place, like theologically. So I don't agree with him there. But when you're doing, when I'm doing, when I did research on the resurrection, you've got to think about some really key issues. Like, for example, one of the things about reading the Gospels, reading about miracles in the Bible is if you're a skeptic, you will come at reading that material in a biased way, and if you're a believer, you will come reading that material in a biased way. There's always that bias. And as he mentioned there, David Hume talks about causality and that we can't really know anything. What he means is that any event that happens, there's always within that event at the real light atomic level or the quantum level, we don't really observe where quarks are coming from, for example. We don't really fully observe what's happening at the quantum level, how a causal event interacts with another event. We might see my finger hitting my finger. But if we go to the deeper structures of reality, we can't see fully what's going on. That's what David Hume was saying. And that's what led to more of a less more of a less sorry a more of a probabilistic theory of knowledge in the 1920s when quantum physics was discovered. And it was realized that there were things that we didn't really know what was going on at the quantum level, and it began, people began to realize that actually we don't know as much as we think we know. And so probability theory came in epistemology and scientific knowledge. What has that got to do with Jesus studies, the historical Jesus studies and the resurrection? Well, it means when you get people like Dawkins or you get these skeptics saying miracles couldn't have happened, that's being dogmatic concerning our understanding of what we don't know concerning what happens at the quantum level. That goes back, right back to Hume saying that we don't know how ultimately causal actions are actually happening. So, in other words, if you've got an understanding of philosophy, an understanding of these issues. They helped me to be an apologist on the resurrection. I know that was complicated stuff. Earl Doughty. Earl Doughty is an atheist. He's a fringe scholar. He's not really accepted in the academic world, but the atheists love him, and a lot of atheists use his material. A lot of atheist scholars like Richard Carrier. He's written a book called Jesus Puzzle that he zealously pushes. The big idea of Doughty is that the church has done a conspiracy against a conspiracy of silence. The Jesus of New Testament is a mythical take. This is what he thinks. Doughty thinks this is so as the Apostle Paul does not mention much about Jesus' life. Paul is a mystical writer, and the New Testament is a pastiche of ancient mythology and ancient non-biblical writers, such as Baruch, Wisdom Scholar, etc. This idea that Jesus was not a historical figure down to the apostle not mentioning much about the life of Jesus is absurd. First Paul, on a number of occasions, does refer to the life of Christ. For example, in 1 Corinthians passage, he quotes the Lord Jesus' very words in 1 Corinthians 11:23. What is more, everywhere Paul's letters is an application of the life and death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. The accusation that the Apostle Paul was mystical fails to realize both in the book of Romans, Romans 1:3-4 and Romans 3:15, and Galatians 1, chapter 1, verse 1 and 6, that Paul saw Jesus as a real historical time, in his real historical time. Paul's whole spiritual experience is based on this. I've dealt with the bright, dying and rising gods elsewhere, which I'll come back to that. I say, he uses the Book of Baruch, the Song of Solomon. A close examination of these books revealed the main theological themes and colors are completely different from the New Testament. For example, the Song of Solomon is quite clearly a mixture of Greek philosophy pontificating the ethical good life. The New Testament is about the grace, the salvation the Messiah has given. What is more, we look at early Christian documents such as the Shepherd of Hermes, the Dedicae and Ignatius to Trallians, Ignatius to Smyrnaeans, and Ignatius to Polycarp, Clement 21:1. These sources have a clear message of Christianity being salvific religion rooted in the cross and resurrection. The Shepherd of Hermes in 659 and Dedicae in chapter 9 undergird the belief of the historical death of Christ. If one replies that actually the letter do not mention the resurrection and the gospel of Thomas also does not mention the resurrection, this implies the resurrection was a later addition to the myth. My reply is this: the gospel of Thomas is clearly a secret revelation. In other words, it's Gnostic language. What we see then is the Gospel of Thomas is an early development of Gnosticism. The reason the Dedicae and the Shepherd of Hermes do not mention the resurrection is these books take for granted these teachings. They merely build on them concerning the ethical life rather than the gospel. But we still have clear indication they are rooted in the Orthodox teaching of the church. It simply cannot be denied that the first century there was a clear idea of the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Papias, who was around 130 AD, stated by Eusebius, who was no friend of Papias, makes it clear that the Gospels were around in the early days as Mark, based on Peter, etc. So what does all that mean? Well, basically what that means is you've got an atheist scholar who's used widely by these people on the internet. It basically says Paul could not have written the Jesus could not have existed, because Paul doesn't mention anything historical about Jesus. What I showed there is that he actually does. He mentions key words that Jesus used, and his main job was to apply the Christian faith. And in his theology, he basically did believe Jesus was a real historical figure. That's very clear. When Earl Doughty starts to quote Baruch and Song of Solomon and talk about there's a spiritual, the New Testament got these ideas of a spiritual Jesus from those texts, he's quoting those texts out of context, and these texts don't back up what he's saying. And the other thing is that it's clear the early church fathers, there was a belief in the resurrection of Christ as a real historical figure. And also, the Gospels were early historical source material. They were at least around after 70 AD in the first century. I would say they were before the first 70 AD, but they were first century source material, which strengthens the case against Earl Doughty. Okay? But Earl Doughty is a guy that a lot of internet people read, atheist internets, right? And a lot of these atheist scholars get their ideas from this Earl Doughty. David Hume's sophisticated argument against the resurrection. Okay. One major bastion about the resurrection is miracles do not happen in the natural world. David Hume was a predicts this idea. He writes, Habermas says, a miracle may be accurately defined as a transgression of nature by a particular violation of deity or by the interposition of the invisible agent. For David Hume, empirical data was the best source of confirming or not confirming a miracle. This is rooted in experience of the natural order. Seeing we do not normally experience such phenomena, of natural explanation should be the most preferred. Modern objections to miracles are just modifications of this basic concept. So basic Hume has basically played a central role in a critique of the resurrection of Christ. And the problems with Hume's argument is because of Hume's argument is a circular argument, basically. Things don't happen because they've not happened. That's what he's saying. Miracles don't happen because they've never happened. But that begs the question. It just begs the question, I mean, just because you haven't observed miracles happening doesn't necessarily mean miracles don't happen. Because at the end of the day, you don't have all knowledge. You can't know everything. So you don't know where a miracle might have come in to our historical time frame. So what you should do as a skeptic, really, is actually study wherever the miracle claims have come. Not to push out a miracle beforehand, before you've even looked at a miracle. Well, miracles don't happen because they don't happen. Well, I'm presenting you with a miracle that's happened. Yeah, but it doesn't happen because miracles don't happen. So you're just being dogmatic. You've got to look at the actual miracle claim and investigate it rather than rule it out beforehand. And that's what David Hume is doing. And the issue there is criteria. I mean, what criteria does a skeptic have for investigating miracles? How are you going to look at a miracle and say that it's not a miracle? And what you find with skeptics is that they don't have a criteria. 90.9% of skeptics, when you ask them, well, okay, if you're open to looking at miracles, what criteria do you have for investigating them? And 99.9% of atheists and skeptics will not have a criteria, which shows the disingenuousness. It's no good saying, as a skeptic, I don't believe in miracles. Okay. Are you willing to look at a miracle claim? Yeah, but I don't believe in them. Okay. If you're going to look at that claim, what's your criteria for looking at it? Well, I don't have one. So you're not really open-minded. David Hume actually developed a criteria. He developed a 5 or 6 point criteria. He was saying, so long as they're educated, if someone's educated in the claim, there's a miracle, etc., if it's good quality evidence. And he gave basically 5 or 6 criteria. And so he did an investigation into miracles in the time of Pascal. There were these French Catholics in France. They said they'd experienced miracles. So David Hume looked at the research, looked at the testimonies of these people, and the criteria that he actually had. When he investigated the miracles, he had to admit that from his criteria that the miracles fitted. They actually fitted, so would prove that there are miracles from his own criteria. But it still didn't convince David Hume. He still didn't become a believer. But yet he had a criteria. What I'm saying is, at least he had a criteria. But even when he used his criteria, he found that there was evidence for miracles, but he still didn't then go on to believe. All this information can be found in Gary Habermas's PhD, if you want to find this out. Okay, there's notes here. Ancient evidence for the non-Christian sources, which we've looked at. Much contested. Skeptics like to contest this information. And you need to do a bit of research, or else you're going to be put off your faith. If you're on college campus and you're debating atheists or trying to share your faith, this historical information, you need to get some background information on the ancient historical sources, because the atheists and the skeptics are going to call you out. And if you don't know the background to these sources, then it's going to weaken your arguments, it's going to weaken you. So be prepared, because they will call you out, okay? Or if you're sharing with people just your faith and sharing about Christianity, and you give them some of this information that I'm going to give you, you need to make sure that you know about these ancient texts, know the history of them, know the scholarship behind them, so that you're intellectually honest. Don't mislead the public. It's very easy to quote these ancient texts and mislead the public. The atheists do it a lot, the skeptics do it a lot, but we don't want to do that. Okay. So, evidence for Tacitus. This is written by Michael Gleghorn, and okay. And He says, although there is overwhelming evidence that the New Testament is an accurate, trustworthy historical document, many people are still reluctant to believe what it says unless there is some independent non-biblical testimony. Interesting point there. You need to make it clear when you're talking to people on the ground in evangelism and when you're preaching or when you're pastoring or even at an academic debating level. You need to make it clear that you can use the Bible as historical evidence because it's gone around, it goes around like wildfire on the ground in everyday life and in the academic world, and it goes something like this: don't use the Bible to prove the Bible. So whenever you quote a Bible text, you say, oh well, you're just quoting a Bible text. You need to make it clear to them that they're being anti-intellectual, that actually the Bible is taken seriously as an ancient document, and you can use it as an ancient historical source material. So you can use the Gospels as ancient historical document, just like you could use a letter of Voltaire or a letter of a Persian king, etc. Okay? So that argument doesn't wash. You can always turn that around and say, no, I can use the Bible as ancient historical source material. And we'll get into it in a bit, but skeptics will grant you certain books. They'll grant you a number of Paul's epistles that they know historically go back to what Paul wrote. And so you can say, well, Paul wrote this, and this is what he says, this is etc. It's historical material. Mustn't let people get away with it, saying to you, oh, you're proving the Bible with the Bible. You know, you need to say, wait a minute, no, you don't understand history. You don't understand history. This is not a fair argument. I'm quoting the Bible not as inspired. I'm quoting it as an ancient document. Now deal with that. And they can't deal with that. The other thing as well, or epistemologically as well, when someone brings up you're trying to prove the Bible with the Bible, you can always turn around and say to them, well, give me a proof for your reason. 99% of people in the UK will not understand what you've just said. And most people in America would not understand, and around the world. When they put to you're trying to prove the Bible with the Bible, you say to them, you prove to me the validity of your reason. And they'll say, well, and they might say something, well, what do you mean? They might give you an argument. They might say, well, I prove my reason with my experience or whatever. And you say, ah, now you just said to me, prove to me, don't use the Bible to prove the Bible. But you're using reason to prove reason, right? In other words, all knowledge is circular. It's whether your circular knowledge is actually consistent. That's presuppositional apologetics. So call people out on that. When they say to you, don't prove the Bible with the Bible, you say to them, don't prove to me reason with reason. That'll get them every time. That will confuse them because most people have not thought it through. All right? Just some little epistemological sides there. Like I said, this is a seminar on the historical Jesus and the resurrection, giving you the scholarship. I'm going through loads of issues. So this is going to be a long video, a resource video to go back to and keep playing and get some ideas and thoughts. All right? So he says, in the introduction to one of his books, F.F. Bruce, top scholar, tells about a Christian correspondent who was told by an agnostic friend that apart from obscure reference in Josephus and the like, there was no historical evidence for the life of Jesus. This, he wrote to Bruce, had caused him great concern and some little upset in his spiritual life. He concludes his letter by asking, is such collateral proof available? If not, are these lessons reasons for the lack of it? Let's begin our inquiry with a passage that historian Edwin Yamuchi calls probably the most important reference to Jesus outside the New Testament. Porting on Emperor Nero's decision to blame Christians to the fire, that had destroyed Rome in AD 64. The Roman historian Tacitus wrote, "Nero fastened the guilt on a class hated for their abomination called Christians by the populace Christus, from whom the name at its origin, suffered the extreme penalty during the reign of Tiberius at the hand of Pontius Pilatus, and a most mischievous superstition thus checked for a moment again broke out not only in Judea, the first source of the evil, but even in Rome." Now, skeptics will bombard this. You know, imagine you got a ship and it's got 50 cannons on, and you're coming up to another ship and you just blast your 50 cannons. Well, the atheists and skeptics blast Tacitus as hard as they can. And so you need to know information about Tacitus, the Roman historian, that generally he was a reliable historian. We don't have all of Tacitus' writings, we only have fragments. For example, we also need to know about Tacitus that when he talked about religious people, he would go and find out, you know, religious leaders. He would actually go out and find information about those religious leaders. He would look at the documents and eyewitness material. So that's the kind of historian that he was, generally speaking. Just a note, a side note, and this is an important note, is all historians are biased, all right? A lot of people will say, oh, well, if you're quoting from the Gospels, they're biased. You need to remember, all historians are biased. Tacitus, Josephus, historians today, every historian is biased. Very, very important to press that home to people, because people will say, give me objective evidence about Jesus' existence from historians that we're not Christians or whatever. We want objective evidence. Listen, all historians are biased. We can have objective evidence, but it's still coloured a bit with people's bias. Doesn't mean to say we can't know facts from history, but we can't play the game that we're all neutral and everybody's neutral. It's just not the truth, all right? So, anyhow, the point about Tacitus is he mentions the historical Christ, that Christ existed. If people say that Christ did not exist, if you say that he didn't die on a cross, this is real historical fact that we're seeing here. We're seeing an enemy of Christianity writing about Jesus. Now the skeptics, some internet atheists who obviously are not so smart, will say, well, we don't know if it's Jesus Christ. Christus might not be Christ. That kind of argument that floats around the internet a ton is really pathetic. And it's not even worth bothering about, really. If you hear that kind of stuff, you just want to tell them you're not being rational. I mean, you've got Christus, you've got Pontius Pilate, you've got the origin of the Christian church all mentioned in that passage. It's obvious that that is about Jesus Christ. So, if you go on EP Holding, JP Holding, Tectonics Apologetic Resource, he has an article on this, Tacitus, and you will get a good article that will tell you why this Tacitus passage is excellent historical material about Jesus, and it will give you all the scholars and what they say. Very, very good, very, very good resource and article. I'm going to sit back a bit. Just relax. Like I said, it's a seminar and it's got a long time to go, a lot of material to give. Evidence from Pliny, another important source of evidence about Jesus and early Christianity, can be found in the letters of Pliny the Younger to Emperor Trajan. Pliny was the Roman governor of Bithynia in Asia Minor. In one of his letters, dated around AD 112, he asked Trajan's advice about the appropriate way to conduct legal proceedings against those who were accused of being a Christian. Pliny says that he needed to consult the emperor about this issue because a great multitude of every age, class, and sex stood accused of Christianity. Pliny writes, "They were in the habit of meeting on a certain fixed day, before it was light, when they sang an alternative verse to a hymn to Christ as to a God, and bound themselves by a solemn oath, not to any wicked deed, but never to commit any fraud, theft, or adultery, never to falsify their word, nor deny a trust when they should be called upon to deliver it, after which it was their custom to separate, then assemble to partake of food. But food of an ordinary and innocent kind." This passage provides us with a number of interesting insights into the beliefs and practice of early Christians. First, we see the Christians regularly met on a certain fixed day for worship. Second, their worship was directed to Christ, demonstrated that they firmly believed in his divinity. Furthermore, one scholar interprets Pliny's statement that hymns were sung to Christ as to a god as reference to the rather distinctive fact that, unlike other gods who were worshipped, Christ was a person who had lived on earth. If this interpretation is correct, Pliny understood that Christians were worshipping an actual historical person as God. Of course, this agrees perfectly in the New Testament doctrine that Jesus was both God and man. Not only does Pliny's letter help us understand what early Christians believe about Jesus' person, it also reveals the high esteem to which they held his teaching. For instance, Pliny notes that Christians bound themselves by a solemn oath not to violate various moral standards. Again, I think the value of Pliny is, it's putting it all together. It confirms the historical background of the New Testament. In the book of Acts, it talks about when they worshipped, and the Pliny's letter backs the book of Acts up. It also shows right early on in the Christian faith they were worshipping Jesus. Now, Dr. Price's argument goes something like this. He would say, "Well, what surprises me is when I look at these religions, how myth can start right at the beginning, right at the beginning of an event." So, for example, you can have a prophet in a cult and they can die, and within a few days, myths can begin. I think that kind of argument is too simplistic. In this Pliny passage, it's quite clearly Pliny is saying that the Christians were worshipping Jesus as a god, and was historical. And you gotta ask yourself, how did these first century Jews, who were Orthodox Jews, by the way, move into a belief that Jesus was God and died and rose again? How did they get to that point? Why would Jews say that Jesus rose from the dead as a vision when Orthodox Jews believed in a physical resurrection, not a visionary resurrection? Why would the Jews, do that and then begin to worship Jesus? Basically, if you look at the historical context of Judaism, the Jews would not have done that. Orthodox Jews would not have done that. Pharisaical Jews would not have done that. So it doesn't make sense. And the letter of Pliny just basically backs up what the New Testament, the picture that the New Testament paints, that the early church was worshipping Jesus. Okay, the next one. Evidence from Josephus. Excuse me. Perhaps the most remarkable reference to Jesus outside the Bible can be found in the writings of Josephus, a first century Jewish historian. On two occasions in his Jewish Antiquities, he mentions Jesus. The second less revealing reference describes the condemnation of one of James by the Jewish Sanhedrin. This James says Josephus was the brother of Jesus, the so-called Christ. F.F. Bruce points out how this agrees with Paul's description of James in Galatians 1:19 as the Lord's brother. And Edwin Yumuchi informs us that the few scholars have questioned that Josephus actually penned the passage. And interesting as this brief reference is, there is an earlier one which is truly astonishing, called the Testimonium Flavium. The relevant portion declares, "About this time there lived Jesus, a wise man, indeed one ought to call him a man, for he wrought surprising feats. He was the Christ. When Pilate condemned him to be crucified, those who had come to love him did not give up their affection for him. On the third day he appeared, restored to life, and the tribe of Christians has not been disappeared." Now, a lot of scholars, excuse me, a lot of scholars over the years have questioned whether this is actual genuine Josephus. And basically, the scholarly world is split into three main camps. There's a small minority of scholars who say that the whole passage has been completely interpolated by some 4th-century monk, and this is not real Josephus. Then there are a small minority of scholars on the other side who say this is pure, solid Josephus and faithful. And then there is a large majority of scholars in the middle who say this is faithful Josephus, but there's been a little bit of interpolation. Now, the internet atheist and scholars like Richard Carrier will tell the public, blatantly lie to the public, and tell you that most scholars believe that Josephus' passage has been completely interpolated. It is not faithful to Josephus, and that's a barefaced lie that he tells you. And also, people on like atheist shows will tell you the same, and it's just a complete utter lie. They're completely lying to you and misrepresenting to you and trying to confuse you. I'm telling you authoritatively, who's looked into this in depth, I'm telling you authoritatively as someone who actually read most of Josephus' book concerning where this text come from, and also looked at the history of Josephus' scholarship. I'm telling you now authoritatively, after reading the whole history of the scholarship on Josephus, from the first scholar who questioned Josephus right up to the present day, that most scholars believe that the Josephus text has been a little bit of interpolation. Someone's changed one or two words. But generally speaking, it's accurate about the life of Jesus. And what we learn is essentially what the New Testament tells us about Jesus. We learn that he died under Pontius Pilate. We learn that the church followed Jesus. We learn that he did much, he did miracles, etc. So it's an important piece of historical information, and you mustn't let the skeptics take you away from it. But when you're talking to people on the ground, when you're evangelizing people, and you say there's historical evidence for Jesus, and you say in Josephus, what I do when I'm talking to people on the ground, and I'm doing evangelism on the ground, and I say, you know, there's historical evidence for Jesus dying on a cross, and I'll say Josephus. I'll tell people that the score about the scholarship. I'll say there are scholars that say it's been interpolated. And I'd say that most scholars agree that there's been a little bit of interpolation, but it's genuine Josephus. So I'll be intellectually honest and I'll tell them the background of the Josephus scholarship just quickly. So don't say Josephus said Jesus rose from the dead. Josephus said Jesus died on a cross or died under Pontius Pilate. And leave it at that because you're giving a false impression. You've got to mention that there's possibly a little bit of interpolation in, but it's generally accepted as genuine Josephus. All right, so be intellectually honest. Don't give a false impression. Evidence from the Talmud. There are only a few clear references to Jesus in the Talmud, a collection of Jewish rabbinical writings compiled between approximately AD 70 to 500. Given this time frame, it is natural to suppose that earlier references to Jesus are more likely to be historically reliable than later ones. The case of the Talmud, the earliest period of compilation, compared between AD 70 to 200, the most significant reference to Jesus from this period states, on the eve of the Passover, Yeshu was hanged. 40 days before the execution took place, a herald cried, "He is going forth to be stoned because he has practiced sorcery and enticed Israel to apostasy." Now, some skeptics, like Richard Carrier, would just dismiss that and say, "Well, it's not in accord with the Gospels, so therefore, it's ridiculous." But it tells you the time. The word hanged was a typical word used actually for as a synonym of crucifixion, by the way. 40 days before the execution took place, a herald cried, "He is going forth to be stoned because he has practiced sorcery." Well, we know that they thought the Pharisees and others didn't like him doing miracles. And we know that they thought he was blasphemous in the from the Gospels, and that is verified in enticed Israel to apostasy. So there's what you can get from that is there's been a little adding of tradition in there by the Pharisees or the Jews that were writing these texts, but that there is a general confirmation of the Gospels there. So it is helpful historical material. Let's examine the passage, says the writer. You may have noticed that it refers to someone named Yeshua. So why do we think this is Jesus? Actually, Yeshua or Yeshua is how Jesus' name is pronounced in Hebrew. But what does the passage mean by saying that Jesus was hanged? Doesn't the New Testament say he was crucified indeed? But the term hanged can function as a synonym for crucified. For instance, Galatians 3:13 declared that Jesus was hanged. Luke 23:39 applies this term to the criminals who were crucified with Jesus. So the Talmud declares that Jesus was crucified on the eve of Passover. But what of the cry of the herald that Jesus was on to be stoned? This may imply indicate what the Jewish leaders were planning to do. If so, Roman involvement changed their plans. Another piece of evidence is Lucian of Samosata, a second century Greek satirist. One of his works he wrote of the early Christians as follows. The Christians worshipped a man in this day, a distinguished personage who introduced the novel rites and was crucified on that account. It was impressed on them by their original lawgiver that they are all brothers. for the moment that they are converted and deny the gods of Greece and worship the crucified sage and lift after his laws. Although Lucian is jesting here at the early Christians, he does make some significant comments about the founder. For instance, he says that Christian worship a man who introduced the novel rites. And though this man followers clearly thought quite highly of him, he so angered many of his contemporaries with his teaching that he was crucified. Although Lucian does not mention his name, he is clearly referring to Jesus. But what did Jesus teach arouse such wrath? According to Lucian, he taught that all men are brothers from the moment of their conversation. That's harmless enough. But what did this conversion involve? It involved denying the Greek gods and worshipping Jesus and living according to his teaching. It's not difficult to imagine someone being killed for teaching that. So the point that I want to stress is, first of all, there is this ancient historical material about Jesus in the Talmud, Tacitus, Josephus, Suetonius, Pliny, and many others. And basically, if you're going to use that material in an academic debate, you need to know the background of that material. So, for example, I've read Josephus as much as I can. So when I quote Josephus, I know what I'm talking about. So in a debate, if you're going to debate people, make sure you check your sources, check the background to these ancient sources. You'll find that most skeptics don't do that. The other thing as well, if you're in debate with a skeptic, if you're in an academic debate, you've got to watch out for this, is if you're in an academic debate with a Richard Carrier or Bart Ehrman, or any of these atheists, what they will do sometimes is they will throw out, especially people like Carrier and atheist scholars like that, they'll throw out a quotation from Philo or a quotation from Josephus or a quotation from the Dead Sea Scrolls or something like that. They'll just throw an ancient text from the Qumran or something like that, that nobody, hardly anybody's ever read. So they'll quote a bit of Philo that you've never read, or the Song of Baruch, or the Song of Solomon. And they'll quote it, and nobody knows the background to that quotation. So, for example, Richard Carey is very often, he'll quote something like from the Song of Isaiah, not the Book of Isaiah in the Bible. And he'll quote it and he'll say, you know, that shows you that there was a spirit, they believed in the spiritual Christ. And because nobody knows the background to Isaiah, Song of Isaiah, or if nobody knows the background to these Qumran and all these things, they win by default because the audience is listening and they don't know the background. When you're in debate, you need to call these people out. When they start quoting things that nobody else has read, you need to make sure that you've read it. I've checked, and I continue to check these atheist scholars' quotations. I've checked Richard Carrier's quotations, and they're not honest quotations. He's not quoting the ancient text. He'll quote Philo, he'll quote Josephus about the resurrection and what they believed, and when you check what they believed, he's not quoting them faithfully. So be careful when you're in an academic debate or discussion with atheists or skeptics. They will bring quotations from these ancient sources. You need to make sure that you know the background to these sources. What I would also say, if you're a Christian and you want to learn about the historical Christ, you need to do your research about these ancient sources and find out the background to them, and read wider. If you're gonna quote Philo, Make sure that you've read Philo in context. If you're going to quote Josephus, make sure that you've read a good deal of Josephus. Do you see what I mean? Just read widely and dig deep. Just some quotations here from the Huffington Post. This is on Mithraism. There's a big movement among some atheists, some scholar, atheists, not atheist scholars, but atheists on the internet. And the skeptics on the internet, they're like chameleons. If you beat them in an academic debate, or if you beat them in an area of scholarship, they'll chameleonly move, conveniently move, or chameleonly move the goalpost. I have done this a number of times. I remember a few years ago, some atheists said, "Do you believe in the dying and rising gods?" That because in the ancient world there were many dying and rising gods who died on. Who were born on the 25th of December and all the rest of it, had virgin births. And I did research on it, came back, did the videos. Next thing I know, the atheists melted away. Only to return with another theory. Now that's what they'll do. Once you corner them and nail them in another area, they'll melt away and start another issue. A lot of them are not intellectually honest. Some are, but most of them, especially on the internet, are not intellectually honest. When you pin them down and you get them on an area, they'll melt away and bring up another issue. All right, you got to watch that. Okay. Now, let's just read this Huffington Post. It's, He says, few of these Mithraists are actually scholars trained in ancient history, religion, biblical studies, or any cognate field, let alone in the ancient languages generally thought to matter for those who want to say something with any degree of authority about a Jewish teacher who allegedly lived in the first century Palestine. There are a couple of exceptions of the hundreds and thousands of mythicists who, to my knowledge, actually have a PhD credentials in relevant fields of study. But even taking these into account, there is not a single Mithraist who teaches the New Testament or early Christianity or even classics at any credited institution of higher learning in the Western world. And it is no wonder why these views are so extreme and so unconvincing to 99% of the real experts that anyone holding them is as likely to get a teaching job in an established department of religion as a six-day creation is likely to land on the bona fide department of biology. Right. So, we. There is a kind of jihadist Mithraist out there. They're very passionate. They're very, very zealous on the internet. These Mithraists do say that Jesus was a myth and he came from the Mithra religion. Mithra religion is an esoteric, various types of religion, religious thing, religious motifs. And ideas that were going around in the ancient world, in before the Roman Empire and during the Roman Empire. And basically, the idea is that Christianity was part of this Mithraist development. And Bart Ehrman makes it very clear. I mean, Richard Carrier and Dr. Price are two of these kind of people, these Mithraist people. And basically, apart from them, there aren't many, they haven't got many, many scholars in this field that are of great a great scholarship. Basically, they're pumping ignorance It's interesting to note, if you look at the history of the Mithra religion, I've said this a few times, I read about 1,000 years of this Mithra religion, right? What you find is there are hardly any ancient historical texts that they actually wrote. There are no gospels, there are few hymns. But the only things that we know about the Mithra religion, and if I find my notes, we can go into that detail. The only thing that we know is what historians and other people have written about them. The Mithra religion, in 500 BC in Persia, was not the same as Mithra religion in 500 BC in Greece. And the Mithra religion in 100 AD was not the same as the Mithra religion in 400 BC. In other words, the Mithra religion changed and moved and ossified and not solidified and moved all over the place. And when we try to understand the Mithra religion, we haven't got any text to give us the interpretation of what they believed. When Mithras talk about what this religion was all about, they get it from statues of bulls that are people slaughtering bulls, or pictures of trees or whatever. They get them from pictures and statues, and then the researcher fills in the blanks and says this is what they actually believed. In other words, it's a very, very nebulous scholarship that goes in to try and understand Mithraism. And then these Mithraists take this very nebulous kind of scholarship and then throw it into the mix and say Christianity's come out of that. That's a very, very weak position to start from. Page 145, Dominic Crossan in Jesus, a Revolutionary Biography, says, Jesus' death by crucifixion under Pontius Pilate is as sure as anything historical can ever be. For if no follower of Jesus had written anything for 100 years after his crucifixion, we would still know about him from two authors, not among his supporters. The names are Flavius Josephus and Cornelius Tacitus. Atheist Gerd Ludemann. Jesus' death as a consequence of crucifixion is indisputable. The Resurrection of Christ, page 50. E.P. Sanders, The Historical Figure of Jesus, New York, Penguin Books, 1993, says that Jesus' followers and later Paul had resurrection experiences is, in my judgment, a fact. What the reality was that gave rise to the experience, I do not know, pages 279 to 280. I do not regard deliberate fraud as a worthwhile explanation. Many of the people in these lists were to spend the rest of their lives proclaiming that they had seen the risen Lord, and several of them would die for their cause. Moreover, a calculated deception should have produced great unanimity. Instead, there seems to have been competitors. I saw him first, no, I did. Paul's tradition that 500 people saw Jesus at the same time has led some people to suggest that Jesus suffered mass hysteria. But mass hysteria does not explain the other traditions. Pages 279 to 282. Finally, we know that after his death, his followers experienced what they described as the resurrection, the appearance of living but transformed person who actually died. They believed this, they lived it, and they died for it. Bart Ehrman, it is historical fact that some of Jesus' followers came to believe that he had been raised from the dead soon after his execution. We know some of these believers by name. One of them, the Apostle Paul, claims quite plainly to have seen Jesus alive after his death. Thus, for the historian, Christianity begins after the death of Jesus, not with the resurrection itself, but with the belief in the resurrection. The New Testament, a historical introduction to the early Christian writings. Third edition, New York, Oxford University Press, page 204. The Gospel According to Bart. What about those writers like Acharya S, The Christian Conspiracy, or Timothy Freke and Peter Grandy, The Jesus Mysteries? Who say that Jesus never existed, that Christianity was invented religion, the Jewish equivalent of the Greek mystery religions? This is an old argument, even though it shows up every 10 years or so. The current craze that Christianity was a mystery religion like these other mystery religions, the people who are saying this are almost always people who know nothing about the mystery religions. They read a few popular books, but they're not scholars of mystery religions. The reality is we know very little about the mystery religions. The whole point, that's what I've just been saying, the whole point of the mystery religions is that they are secret. So I think it's crazy to build on ignorance in order to make a claim like this. I think the evidence is just so overwhelming that Jesus existed that it's silly to talk about him not existing. I don't know anyone who is a responsible historian who is actually, this is Bart Ehrman, that is actually, sorry. I don't know anyone who is a responsible historian who is actually trained in the historical method, or anyone who is a biblical scholar who does this for a living, who gives any credence at all to any of this. Bart Ehrman interview with David V. Barrett, The Gospel According to Bart, 2007. Robert E. Van Vust, Professor of New Testament at Westminster Theological, Western Theological Seminary. In his discussion on the historical evidence of Jesus outside the New Testament states, the theory of Jesus' non-existence is now effectively dead as a scholarly question. Jesus Outside the New Testament, An Introduction to the Ancient Evidence, page 14. Mark Allen Powell, a professor. So if you're a Mithraist today, you're in denial. You are in denial. And you're not willing to face the evidence. Mark Allen Powell, a professor of New Testament and chairman of Historical Jesus at the Society of Biblical Literature, puts it harsh, stating anyone who says that today, i.e. that Jesus didn't exist, in the academic world at least, gets grouped with the skinheads who say that there was no Holocaust, and the scientific holdouts who want to believe the world is flat. Mark A. Powell, Jesus is a figure in history, how modern historians view the man from Galilee. I like that. F.F. Bruce, in his popular The New Testament Documents Are They Reliable, said, some writers may toy with the fancy of Christ's myth, but they do not do on the grounds of historical evidence. The historicity of Christ is an axiomatic for an unbiased historian, as the history of Julius Caesar. It's not historians who propagate the Christ myth theories, Bruce in New Testament Documents. No one in scholarly circles dealing with ancient Judaism and early Christianity of any religion or non-religious persuasion holds the view that Jesus never existed. You're entitled to your own opinion, but not to your truth. Larry Hurtado, specialist in New Testament and Christian origins, former professor of New Testament language at the University of Edinburgh. Of course, the doubt as to whether Jesus re really existed as us unfounded and not worth refutation. No sane person can doubt that Jesus stands as founder behind the historical movement. His first distinct stage is represented by the oldest Palestinian community, Rudolf Bultmann, Jesus and the Word, page 13, 1958. To doubt the historical existence of Jesus at all was reserved for an untrained, tendentious criticism of modern times, in which it is not worthwhile to enter in here. J. Bornkamm, Jesus of Nazareth, 1960. I am of the opinion, and it is an opinion shared by every serious historian, that the theory that Jesus never existed, that he was purely mythical figure, is historically untenable. W. Markson, The Resurrection of Jesus, of Nazareth, page 19. To sum up, modern critical methods fail to support the Christ myth theory. It has again and again been answered and annihilated by first-rank scholars. Recent years, no serious scholar has ventured to postulate the non-historicity of Jesus, or at any rate, very few, and they have not succeeded in disposing of the much stronger, indeed abundant evidence of the contrary historian Michael Grant, Jesus of an Historian's Review of the Gospels, page 200. Page 204, page 34, of Richard Burridge and Graham Gould, Jesus Now and Then, 2004, page 34. There are those who argue that Jesus was a figment of the church's imagination, that there was never a Jesus at all. I have to say that I do not know any respectful critical scholar who says that anymore. Giza Vermeer's Resurrection, 2008. Let me state it plainly that I accept that Jesus was a real historical person. In my opinion, the difficulties arising from the denial of his existence still vociferously maintained in small circles of rationalist dogmatists far exceed those deriving its acceptance. Craig Evans and Wright, no serious historian of any religious or non-religious stripe, doubts that Jesus of Nazareth really lived in the first century and was executed under the authority of Pontius Pilate, the governor of Judea and Samaria. The Final Days, 2009, page 3. So, as a Mithraist, if you believe that Jesus came out of all these esoteric religions and was part of this Mithraist religion, then, one, how come you're just academically not even on the map? I mean, come on. I honestly can't help but smile, because it's just not a viable option. Okay, convince me as a Mithraist. There's some of you skeptics out there, I know one or two of you, are into Mithraism. Well, here's the question. Give me your text. Give me your ancient text that tells us what Mithraism is. And guess what? You've hardly got any. The only text that you have are a few hymns. End of story. The things that we do know about Mithraism from other historians does not back up what you're saying. Mithraism changed in so many different variety of ways. And as Bart Ehrman said, Mithraism was often a secret cult. The Roman soldiers met in secret, under caves. What does this all got to do with us as Christians? What it tells us is don't buy into these skeptics who come along with their big words and fancy ideas, try to bulldoze your Christian faith, when they say that Jesus was a myth, because the academic world will not back them up. Now, that's not an argument from authority if I can back it up with evidence, and I've just backed it up with evidence by telling you, and that's the evidence, that there is no documentation that can give you a clear understanding of what Mithraism is. It's all theory. It's all supposition. Okay? Now, some atheists and some skeptics will turn around and they will say, well, yeah, but you're trying to play fast and loose here. What you're trying to do is prove that Jesus died and rose again. But that, just because we know that Jesus is a historical figure, doesn't mean to say that Jesus rose again. No, but what it does tell you is whether the Gospels and the ancient texts that we have in Paul's epistles, for example, it does tell you whether those texts are historically reliable. That's the first thing. If they're historically reliable, Then that's the first step in considering whether we're going to listen to their testimony. When you put all the testimony together, all the early church's testimony, and the historical information outside the Bible, outside those gospels and letters, you ask yourself which theory accounts for the facts best. And what you find is the theory or the belief that Jesus Christ rose from the dead actually fits all the facts that we know about Jesus, where the facts that the skeptic brings does not fit the life of Jesus. So this historical reliability of the Gospels, the historical reliability of these ancient texts, is very, very important in the debate. The basic foundation of the proof of the resurrection. I've been accused by Thunderfoot, by Aaron Ra, by DPR Jones, by Aussie, and by many atheists, that I don't understand the argument concerning this. That what they would say is, you can have comic, you can have comics, Marvel comics, and they can have historical detail in. So why should we? We don't believe in Spider-Man just because we can find historical information about Spider-Man in a Marvel magazine. So why are you saying just because the Gospels have historical material, why does that prove that Jesus rose from the dead? My thought to that is, number one, that's an offensive analogy. That is not an intellectually viable analogy. Okay? It's not even on the academic radar for any discussion, serious discussion. Because it's first of all, it's a generality. A comic magazine is not the same as four gospels. It's not the same as Paul's letters. So there's a generality there that's being falsely applied. Secondly, a Marvel comic magazine, okay, we can verify or not whether that person was genuinely writing history or not. We can verify the genre of the text. We know that that's a comic. This is why I get upset with these skeptics. Sometimes these skeptics are just complete idiots and stupid, and that they think they're smart. The genre of the comic is comic, right? The genre of the Gospels is history. That's a very, very important point to make. Okay? The genre of the comic is specifically for the specific purpose of entertainment and to tell a fictional story. That's the genre. We know that's the genre. The genre of the Gospels is to tell a historical story about Jesus' death and resurrection. So the genre, if that genre is trying to tell you history, and it's telling you that Jesus lived and died, and it wants to tell you history of his resurrection, then you've got to judge it in its genre and the context of its genre. And so when you take that literature and you start to read it, and it starts to reveal to you the details of Jerusalem. For example, we've talked about this before. I talked about this with Matthew Bell on one of his shows the other day. And he tried to call me out. Matt, Matthew, I love you, bro. You did try to call me out, but it didn't work. You tried to call me out. And I made this argument, and I said that the Gospels are historically reliable. For example, in the book in Jerusalem, Jerusalem in detail is mentioned over 70 times in the Gospels, in the the Gnostic Gospels is mentioned only 30 times and it's only nebulous, right? And Matthew tried to call me out on that, and he wanted a good source material, and one of his people on his show gave a study Bible that nobody knew, which if that was a good source material, Matthew, I'm sorry, but it was pretty pathetic, bro. Still love you though. It was pretty pathetic. So I got the article where I got it from, and he said it was a good source material because the guy had a PhD and stuff, and he looked a pretty good guy. But then I went and got my Strong Concordance, and then we looked at Jerusalem in the Gospels, and it was more than 70. So it made me look good because my estimate was conservative. And the article that I gave said there were only 16 references of Jerusalem in the Gnostic Gospels. So my estimates were very conservative, and when we looked into it, it actually backed me up more. What I'm trying to say is the genre of the Gospels is historical. That's absolutely important. So the question is, when you start to say the miracles did not happen, listen to this, Aussie. I'm calling you out now, okay? When you start to say that miracles don't happen, or the miracles are mythological, or I'm a bit skeptical about the miracles, okay? If the historian is writing history, okay, and that's what they're trying to do, and that's their way of writing, and there's a number, and they're hitting the mark all the time on the historical things that they're saying, right? And not only one historian is doing it, but you have multiple historians, multiple data, then as a skeptic, you have got to take that history serious. And it's not a question of saying, the resurrection, there's contradictions in it, and the spiritual, it's just a spiritual view of Jesus. No. Because historians work from eyewitness material. Good historians. And so if the genre of these Gospels, if they are using eyewitness material, and then there is multiple attestation, then you as a skeptic have got a major problem. Because if you have got multiple attestation to a miracle or to a resurrection from a variety of sources, from enemies to those who follow Jesus, then you as a skeptic have to sit down and take it more seriously. And you can't come back and start saying, Aussie, this is just to you, bro, that you got to look at every bit of information with skeptical eyes. You can't take that point unless, number one, your criteria is a fair criteria. On the scale of looking at information, historical information, historians have a variety of criteria from a scale to where looking at an ancient text. They will have, some will say, they will not grant any ancient text anything. They're going to be completely, utterly skeptical about any claims an ancient text makes. There are some that will be in the middle and say, well, any ancient text that makes a claim, will accept it provisionally, but we're always going to be a little bit skeptical. And then thirdly, you get other historians that will say that we accept the claims of the ancient text until proven guilty. So that's the broad spectrum of how we look at ancient texts. Three broad spectrums, right? Now, Aussie and some atheists go for this further end where they're completely skeptical and analyzing every detailed bit of information and being skeptical of an ancient text. And if you do that, then you're never really going to believe anything because the end of the day, you don't believe in miracles. So if you don't believe in miracles, you're never going to believe their testimony. And if you're going to be skeptical to the point of always being skeptical about everything, then you're never going to actually believe anything about what the gospel writers are actually saying, really. But if you at least meet them halfway and say, yeah, okay, I'm skeptical, but I will tentatively accept whatever their claims are if they can back it up, then you give the chance of the ancient text a way of verifying itself and allowing it to speak for itself. And if you honestly come to the Gospels and you read the Gospels, you'll find that there's eyewitness material in all the Gospels, that they're historically reliable, that there's eyewitness material, it's multiple. And you can only but think that they really did see Jesus die and rise again. And it's that early church testimony based on that eyewitness material that you're being asked to put your faith in. Now, the question is, did they get it wrong? I mean, Matthew Bell, you said that they could have got it wrong. They could have got it wrong. They could have got it wrong that Jesus didn't rise from the dead, that they saw a vision. But again, it we come back to history, and this is the key. This is why I love this subject. We're coming back to history. The whole point of what we're trying to do in looking at the Gospels is trying to get what the Gospels that trying to understand the times. And when you understand the times, when you understand the way the Jews thought, when you understand the Jewish context, and you say, well, they could have got it wrong. Well, is that consistent with what we know about Jews of that time? Did Jews believe in ghost resurrections, or did they believe in a physical resurrection? Well, you had the Sadducees who didn't believe in a resurrection. You had the Pharisees that believed in a physical resurrection. There were other Jewish sects that had other general ideas about resurrection. A resurrection would come at the end time. There were different nuances of resurrection. But was it really on the cards to believe in a resurrection that was not physical from a Jewish perspective? The Apostle Paul was a Pharisee. Was it really on the cards for him to believe in a Jesus that was resurrected spiritually but not physically? The Jews generally believed when the resurrection was coming, it would be bodily and that it would be at the end of time. So if they're going around saying that Jesus is resurrected and it's a spiritual thing that they've just made up in their minds, that does not fit the historical context of Judaism. So maybe you've got it wrong, Matthew, in your understanding of the historical context of first century Judaism. Maybe you've got it wrong, Ozzy, in your understanding of first century Judaism. Maybe, Ozzy, you need to ditch your Mithraism that you've got, or your little bit of Mithraism. And maybe you need to do some more serious scholarship and think more harder. Because you might be able to use big words, bro, but you certainly don't understand the quest for the historical Jesus and how we look at historical material. And you're certainly not presenting in an honest way the general scholarship of how we have criteria. You've only given the the atheist public, or the public, one part of a criteria that's an extreme understanding of looking at ancient text. You fail to tell them about the whole spectrum of looking at ancient text. If you want to understand more about that, go to the first 100 pages of Lycona, and he goes into detail about historical criteria of how we look at ancient text, whether we're going to be ultimately skeptical. You know, if a text says that it was written by Paul, you can either be completely skeptical, you can either be in the middle of the road, or accept it until proven guilty. Those are the three ways of dealing with ancient texts. Okay. More to go. Ben Witherington on the Jesus puzzle. He did a massive critique of Earl Doughty's The Jesus Puzzle. I won't go into that. It's a quite a hefty article, and I've gone into it in deeper. Yeah, we'll go into what's this? Into the harmony of the resurrection. Got some articles here. First of all, there's an article here. This is a long video. This is an article on answeringislam.org, Resurrection Harmony. If what is recorded in the New Testament is true, the resurrection of Jesus is the most incredible and the most significant event in human history. There are five passages in the New Testament that claim to be historical accounts of what happened to Jesus. And these are, so let's have a look. So look at that, we haven't even got through this pile yet. So I think what we'll do is, we'll look at this, and we'll call this part one. And we'll get some more time. I'm going to read a book on some stuff now. And there's a lot of material that we've covered in this video. And it's been 2 hours. So what we'll do is, as you can see, we've only got through about 1-2% of my notes. Okay, so what we'll do is we'll go through this paper and these papers here that I've got, and maybe do the Ben Witherington paper. So we'll do that. Okay. And then when I get some time, I'll come back to this series. I'll do another series, okay? Okay, let's just turn to a few verses. Let's get some scripture involved. Matthew 28, verse 1 to 20. Matthew 28, 1 to 20. Now after Sabbath, towards the dawn of the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb, and behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled the back and stone and sat on it. His appearance was the lightning, and his clothing white as snow. And for fear of him the guards trembled and became like dead men. But the angel said to the woman, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, but he has risen. He said, 'Come, see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples that he has risen from the dead, and behold, he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him. See, I have told you.' So they departed quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy, and ran to tell the disciples. And behold, Jesus met them and said, 'Greeting.' They came up and took hold of his feet and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, 'Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee, and there they will be see me.' While they were going, behold, some of the guard went into the city and told the chief priests all that had taken place. When they had assembled with the elders to take counsel, they gave a sufficient sum of money to the soldiers and said, 'Tell people, his disciples came by night and stole him away while we were asleep. And if this comes to the governor's ears, we will satisfy him and keep you out of trouble.' So they took the money and did as they were directed, and this story has been spread among the Jews to this day. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, 'All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the earth, to the end of the age.'" Okay. And then there's other scriptures, Mark chapter 16, 1 to 14, Mark 24, 1 to 53, Luke chapter 24, verse 1 to 53, John chapter 20, verse 1 to 29, and 1 Corinthians 15, 1 to 8. Since Christianity stands on or falls whether the resurrection of Christ was an actual, real, historical event, 1 Corinthians 15, 12, 19. We need to ask the question, what marks the five accounts above out as genuine? Independent or semi-independent accounts of actual historical events. In short, how can we trust them? Well, begin by making some general observations concerning eyewitness accounts and historical writing in general. Selection and contradiction. While this may be stating the obvious, it is worth pointing out that historians naturally select which details to include and which to ignore when describing any series of events. This will usually depend on their purpose in writing. It is also common that the eyewitness will describe an event differently from each other, as different points will stand out more strongly for different eyewitnesses. Therefore, historians are usually of the opinion that accounts which claim to be the different authors or eyewitnesses which fail to show any differences of selection or perspective are almost certainly the result of copying or collusion. On the other hand, if the event described by two or more witnesses is genuine, it should be possible to resolve apparent contradictions between their accounts. Incidental corroboration. In the case of two independent accounts of the same event, it is often the case that one report will only make complete sense taken in the light of other. Put simply, this is because both accounts may be true, but both are incomplete. This kind of overlapping to build up the whole picture is to be expected when the events described by multiple witnesses is true. It is also virtually impossible to fabricate unless one writer sits down with a report of the other and deliberately sets out to do so. Historical credibility. Details of the events described should be in harmony with known historical practices, background of the period in question, as well as the harmony with details known from other sources from that period. And four, coherence. Historical accounts should be coherent, self-consistent, and make good overall sense if we to learn from them. For further reading on the subject, historical credibility, E. Carr's What is History in 1987 contains much of value, as does G. R. Elton's The Practice of History, 1969, and the summary containing Colin Brown's History and Faith. We'll go through this quickly. Characters, the people who feature in the accounts of the resurrection of Jesus are as follows. Joseph of Arimathea, a secret follower of Jesus and member of the Jewish High Council. Matthew 27, 57 to 60. Luke 23, 50, 55. John chapter 19, 38, 42. Nicodemus, another secret follower of Jesus. Josephus, sorry, like Joseph, a member of the Jewish High Council. John chapter 3, verse 121. John 7, 50, 52. John 19, 38, 42. Simon Peter, one of the 12 disciples of Jesus. Matthew 4, 18, 6, 16, 17, 20, 24, 18, 21, 19, 27, 26, 37. Mark chapter 3, 16. Mark chapter 5, 37, 9, 2. Luke chapter 22, 8. Luke 24, 12, 34. John 1, 41. John 21, 3, etc. John, one of the 12 disciples, a cousin of Jesus, and also known as the beloved apostle. Matthew 4, 21. Mark 1, 29. Luke 9, 49. John 21, 7 to 20. Acts chapter 1, 13. Mary, mother of Jesus, Matthew 1, 16. Cleopas, also called Clopas or Alpheus, brother of Joseph, and thus Jesus' uncle, John 19:25. Various other apostles and disciples. Mary, also called the other Mary, wife of Cleopas, therefore aunt to Jesus and sister-in-law to the mother Mary. She was also mother of Joseph and the disciples. Matthew 27:61. I'm getting really tired. Siloam, wife of Zebedee, mother of the two disciples. Mary Magdalene, Joanna, wife of Herod Antipas. Hasmonea, Palace, the Jerusalem resident during the Passover. Wife of Herod Antipas, steward. Garden of Gethsemane, the tomb to the north of the city. Bethany, home of Martha, the house of John the Apostle. Writers, Matthew, Mark, Luke. Two important presuppositions. The following is evident from the way that the four Gospel writers have treated the material, and it's important to keep these two points in mind. Incompleteness in reporting the presence of characters, for example, in John 19:25, Mary Magdalene, Salome, Mary the wife of Cleopas, are reported as being at the foot of the cross. However, only Mary Magdalene is mentioned as going to the tomb early on Sunday morning. However, John hardly expected his readers to assume that a young woman was wandering around alone in the dark city streets. When she arrived back from the tomb, her words were, "They have taken the Lord from the tomb, and we don't know where they have put him." John 22. Her plural indicates that she had companions there with her, but John has neglected to mention them. Luke also shows this practice, where in Luke 24:12, He names only Peter as going to the tomb, but in 24:24 refers to some who went there. It is clear that from the point of view of the gospel writers, mentioning one name only does not preclude others being present. This principle was also applied to the angels at the tomb, as we shall see. Telescoping, for example, Luke clearly exhibits the principle. If we just read Luke's account of the resurrection, one would get the impression that all Jesus' appearances and his ascension took place in just one today, in one day. Yet in Acts, which was also written by Luke, he clearly states that the events stretched over 40 days. In his gospel, he telescopes events in order to bring out a particular perspective. Matthew also uses telescoping, especially in the events surrounding the angel's initial descent and later conversation with the woman. Telescoping is not at all uncommon in historical reporting. Okay, we're going to leave it there. I'm getting a bit tired. I couldn't get sleep last night because I didn't go to bed till about 4 o'clock. Because I was preaching all day. I mean, I preached about 4 hours. My adrenaline, your adrenaline gets going. And when I came home, I got home about 9 o'clock at night, and I couldn't relax. My adrenaline was flowing, and I couldn't get any sleep. So what we just looked at there is the way the gospel writers have given their material. I'm going to talk about that just for a minute, and then we're going to finish. And I'll do some more videos and get through these notes eventually, all right? So we'll look at them again. We'll look at the historical Jesus and the resurrection in detail again, and go through my notes. Those who've done it before, I've got other notes that I've not shared with you, so there'll be new stuff as well. So, yeah. So let's just talk about that, what we've just read. You often get people saying that there are contradictions in the resurrection accounts. And the way to answer that is on a few levels. Number one is question what each of the gospel writers, what is their agenda? You know, what are they writing? And you find every historian has an agenda. And every historian will choose the material. That's what the guy was saying in the article. And so you have to understand that when you're reading the Gospel of John, it has a different perspective than the Gospel of Luke. And if you don't understand, for example, that the Gospel of John is looking at the last days of Jesus' life, for example, then you're not going to fully understand that gospel. And so when you come to the resurrection account, you're going to get confused if you don't understand each gospel and the way they're functioning. The second thing is the way they write, like he just noticed there, that just because one person's mentioned doesn't mean to say in the account, it doesn't imply that other people weren't there, so that you could use one name of one person, but there would be people there who were actually at the resurrection scene. And telescoping, the actual compressing of events into what seems a day, which is actually over 40 days. So you've got to be careful that you don't put your ideas about how those texts should be. If you take into consideration how the Gospels look at it from different perspectives. Their writing style, that they're using telescoping, that they're using specific literary methods, then there aren't any contradictions. Don't mean to say we can fully understand how it all comes together, but it's just basically telling us that they had an experience of the resurrected Christ. So, for example, when it says they saw an angel, or they saw two men, or they saw two angels. Well, when it says angel and they saw two men, that's obviously different language for angel. When it says one, another says two, each historian has a right to leave out or put in a historical writing what they want. And if one says there was one and another one says there were two, it's just that they're writing a different emphasis of what they're trying to emphasize in the writing. Even if there was contradictions, which there isn't, but even if there was, it wouldn't overthrow the resurrection, because the plausibility structure, the facts are there for the resurrection. So trying to, if you look at it from an honest historical point of view, the evidence is there. Okay, I'm going to close in a minute. I'm just getting tired. My voice is going. I'm just going to be a, put a song on, and then I'm going to share my testimony about what I think about the resurrection. That's what we're going to do. So I'm just going to put a song on, and then thanks for joining me today. Check out the Lloyd Jones sermon, The Mystery of God. I'll be putting more Lloyd Jones up soon. So I hope you really enjoy that. It looks like the builders are going down. That's the builder. I'm sorry if I sound a bit boring. I'm just a bit tired. I preached for like 4 hours yesterday, and I'm just tired. Holy is I. This place and time, that I might seek and find my God, my God. Oh, I don't yearn for you. I want to burn with passion over you. And only for you, I want to burn with passion over you, and only you, boy, I want you. Your joy is
Just three chords and a melody won't leave you a living legacy without Jesus. Just four songs and a parable might leave you something terrible. Just $5 in an offering won't buy you some prosperity. Just $0.06 of morality won't get you out of your depravity without Jesus. Without Jesus. Thank you.
Song ready. I'm gonna just speak now just for a few minutes on Acts 17, and before I do that, I've put the music section up now, and if you look on my like section, you'll see things that I like, theologians, singers, whatever will come up. And like I said, this is the main hub of the global operations of Jason Burns and the Lord's ministry that I do on the internet. This is the central hub if you want to find out what I'm doing. I'm just looking for my likes. And here we are. Yeah. And there's a lady. She's really good. She's a really good singer. Don't buy into a theology, don't think that I'm buying into a theology. But I like her singing. This is her singing.
Aren't you glad that God cares for the little things? He feeds us just like I sang earlier that way. Like the woman at the well, I was seeking.
Yes.
For things that could not satisfy.
Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
And then I heard my Savior speaking. Draw from my well that never shall run dry.
Amen.
In my cup, Lord, I lift it up, Lord. Come and quench this thirsting of my soul. Bread of heaven, feed me till I want no more.
Okay, folks. We're just going to look at some scripture. And so let's pray. Lord, as we look at your word, we pray that you would bless it to our hearts, fill us with your Holy Spirit, and speak to us all now. May people come to know you as their Lord and Savior. And may they come to trust you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. May those who do not know you, may they be encouraged to come to trust in you. And those who do know you, may they be encouraged in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Okay, let's look at Acts chapter 17. It's on the resurrection of Christ, okay? Acts 17, verse 18. Now, while Paul was waiting for them at Athens, his spirit was provoked within him. He saw the city was full of idols. We'll stop there. We see on the internet, I've been going on the blog shows last night, and the other couple of nights, and I'm hearing all these people discussing and debating, and we see our culture discussing and debating, and at the end of the day, it's idolatry. At the end of the day, you are full of idolatry. You can talk all you want about the philosophy of purpose, the philosophy of intelligent design. You could talk about whatever you want to talk about, politics, about economy, about global warming. But at the end of the day, it's all idols. You've got an idol in your heart right now. Right now, you've got an idol. You're not worshipping God, you're worshipping sex. You're worshipping drugs, you're worshipping going to the gym every night rather than worshipping God in your heart. You're putting your career above God. You're putting yourself above God. You've got an idol right now. No matter how much you talk on these blog shows and how intelligent you come across, you are still worshipping an idol. It might even be the idol of your own intellect, the idol of your own self-importance, and you need to put it away and put God first. Now, while Paul was waiting for them at Athens, his spirit was provoked within him, and he saw the city was full of idols. So he reasoned in the synagogue with Jews and the devout persons in the marketplace every day with those who happened to be there. The Apostle Paul reasoned in the marketplace. We are told many times by the skeptics that Christians are anti-intellectual. And you know, a lot of Christians are anti-intellectual. They're not willing to study. They're not willing to think. But to say just because there are some Christians that are anti-intellectual, that Christianity is anti-intellectual, is completely dishonest. If you actually think about Christianity, it's about evidence. It's about what God has done in Christ dying and rising again. And Paul was busy debating and discussing these facts of history. Okay? He was. So he reasoned in the synagogue with the Jews or the devout persons in the marketplace every day with those who happened to be there. The Apostle Paul was not above reasoning and defending the faith. And so if you're a Christian today, do not be anti-intellectual. I'm not saying be so intellectual that you turn away from the gospel. No, the gospel is central. The word of God is central. But the idea that we cannot think and that we should not think and that we should not read widely and think widely is just stupidity at its height. God has called you to think. He's called you to use your mind to worship and glorify him and to defend the faith in an honest, fair way. If someone asks you a question, you have to try and answer it in an honest way. If it's an honest question, answer it in an honest way. And so Paul was in the marketplace reasoning. He was amongst the people. That's what you and I need to be doing. It's no good being in an academic ivory tower. How many of you theologians and academics are in your universities and you're talking about theology? How many of you have actually gone down into the world and met people, helped people, comfort people, and gone there to the everyday man and woman on the street? Paul was amongst people, reasoning with the people. The church today is in its own little ivory tower. Most churches are in their own little culture, whatever culture that be, whether it be a Welsh chapel or an Anglican chapel or a Methodist or an evangelical. It's still your culture. You need to get out and you need to get amongst the people and reason with them why Jesus Christ died and rose again. Okay. Then it says, Paul said, some of the Epicureans and Stoic philosophers also conversed with him. And some said, what does this babbler wish to say? Others said, he seems to be a preacher of foreign divinities because he was preaching Jesus and the resurrection. the philosophers, the Epicureans and the Stoics, they encountered the Apostle Paul. Now, the Epicureans were people who said, eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we die. And the Stoics were those who said, life was hard, just grit your teeth and move on. But they had contempt for the Apostle Paul's message. And we need to realize that we're never going to be intellectually credible in the world, whether it be in the university, whether it be in your church, or wherever you're going to be in the world. The world is not going to pat you on the back and say, aren't you a Christian and your message is intellectually credible. They're never going to do that. They're always going to put you down. They're always going to make you look small. They're always going to make you think you're thick. They're always going to demonize your belief. That's what the apostle experienced here. The Epicurean philosophers, the Stoic philosophers came with their sophisticated philosophy and they thought, what will this babbler say? And they called him a babbler. And that's what they'll say to you in modern culture. What has this babbler got to say? The feminist theologians, the feminists, the gay rights theologians, the gay rights lobby, whether it be politically on the left or politically on the right, whether it be evolutionists, whether it be skeptics, atheists, whether it be other religions, they'll all say, what has this babbler got to say? And you've got to be recognized that at the end of the day, you've got a message. You're an ambassador of Christ, and you mustn't be cowed down. You mustn't feel ashamed of the gospel. Paul said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. Don't be ashamed. Don't be ashamed when you meet a sophisticated theologian. Don't be ashamed when you meet a sophisticated intellectual. Don't be ashamed if you meet someone clever who can run rings around you. Don't be ashamed of your gospel because Jesus Christ died and he rose again. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation. It's the Spirit of God and the Word of God and the cross of God that will save a soul, not an argument. Not an argument, okay? No argument will ever, ever save a person. Though we will reason with them, though we will debate with them, though we will argue with them, that will never save them. It's the Spirit of God, it's the Word of God, and it's the cross of Christ, okay? That is what will save a soul. And you who are proud and intellectual today, you're a philosopher and you think you're smart, you're a scientist and you think you're smart, you're an intellectual and you think you're smart, let me tell you something, you might be smart, but you will never get into the kingdom of God until you humble yourself and the Holy Spirit opens your eyes and the Word of God penetrates your heart and the cross of Christ breaks your heart. Until you see what Christ did for you at the cross, that he was crucified for you, that he took your wrath as an intellectual, as a scientist, as a thinker, and he died on that cross for you and took the full force of the wrath of God, you're in oblivion with your smartness. You're in oblivion with your intellectualism, and you're going nowhere. I don't care if you've read all the books on philosophy or all the books on historical Christ studies or if you're a smart guy or a girl who knows Hebrew better than anybody else. You're going to hell, and you're going to burn in hell forever if you don't repent and believe in Jesus Christ. And you can argue with me all day long, but at the end of the day, when you die, you're coming before God, and you're going to get judged by God. And you need to trust in him now. And you know that that's the truth. You know, without even me arguing with you, you know in your heart of hearts what I'm saying is the truth of God. And if you don't like it, you don't like God. If you don't like it, you don't like Jesus. If you don't like it, you don't like the Word of God. If you don't like it, you don't like the Spirit of God. If you don't like it, you ain't got a passion for God. And that's your problem. Your problem ain't with me. Your problem's with the Word of God. Your problem ain't with me. Your problem's with God. Your problem ain't with me. Your problem's with Jesus. That's your problem. You need Jesus in your life. Stop being clever. Stop being smart. And start being a man and a woman of Jesus Christ today. And so it says, some Epicureans and Stoic philosophers are conversed with him. Stoics and Epicureans, the Epicureans who believed that eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we die, and the Stoics that life was hard. You know, philosophy and the philosophy of life can be compartmentalized in a few very simple ways of looking at life. You know, most philosophies is either eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we die, or life's difficult and we just get on. Christianity is more than that. It's more than about eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we die. It's more about life is hard and difficult. But do you see something? Your belief in origins, your belief in history, your belief, your philosophical belief will impact your life, what you think of now and what you think of the future. If you don't believe in a resurrection of Christ, some of you will say, well, I'll just have a good time now, get all the sex I can, get all the drink I can, get all the money I can, get all that I can in this life. That's what the implication is if you don't believe in a resurrection of Christ. Or it might be you've got no hope. If you don't believe in a resurrection of Christ and disease sweeps the land, or economy collapse sweeps the land, or disaster sweeps in your life, your reaction is going to be, it's hard, it's tough, but I got to be strong, hold myself in, and get on with life. You see what I mean? Whatever you believe about the future and the present will affect the way you live. If you believe in a resurrection, you'll have a different opinion of life than you will if you don't believe in the resurrection. And things never change, you know. All things never change. History repeats itself. When we have the Stoics today in the nightclubs, there are millions of people in the UK and America and around the world going to the nightclubs and saying, eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we die. And there are many people today around the world who are suffering in nations and going through great tragedy, and they will say, it's a hard thing, I'll keep going, I'll struggle on, I'll just keep going. Okay? So anyhow, some of the Epicureans and Stoic philosophers also conversed with him, and some said, what does this babbler wish to say? Others said, he seems to be a preacher of foreign divinities, because he was preaching Jesus and the resurrection. They took him and brought him to the Areopagus, saying, may we know what this new teaching is that you are presenting? This new teaching. That's what the media is always interested in, the new. What new idea is there? What new thinking is there? The academic world, it's always about what new thinking, new idea. And it's always new. They want to find something new and tittle-tattle all the time. They can't stay with the old truths. They can't stay with the great wise sayings. They can't stay with the truth of Christ. They're looking for something new all the time, new and entertaining. And that's a superficial society, folks. A superficial society that is on one thing one minute and then looking for the new next fix, and then the new next fix is a society that's unstable. And all these intellectuals that you see on Newsnight, they're all looking for something new, tittle-tattle, going around, talking about something, then moving on to the next subject, then moving on to the next subject, and it's all entertainment, but it's all playing while Rome burns, because as they talk as intellectuals, they are going to die, and they're going to meet their maker, my friend. So, may we know what this new teaching is that you're presenting, for you bring some strange things to our ears. We wish to know whether what these things mean. Now, all the Athenians and foreigners who lived would spend their time in nothing except on hearing something new. That's a culture that is not based on God. A culture will always be looking for the new thing. And so Paul, standing in the midst of the Areopagus, said, men of Athens, I perceived that in every way you are religious, for I passed along and observed the objects of your worship. I found also an altar with the inscription, to the unknown God. What therefore you worship as unknown, this I proclaim to you. I would say to you that every human being has a sense of the divine, a sense of God. They might not understand it, but they have a sense of God. Even the atheists, such as the late Christopher Hitchens, and people like Sam Harris and even Dawkins, have often talked about creation, the universe, in divine categories. I'm not saying they believed in a literal God, but they would look to creation and they would say that there is something mysterious, something wonderful, something majestic. That is a sense of Godhood within the atheist. The atheist knows that there is something transcendent about this creation that they see. But all of us have a sense of wonder about this world, and that it points to something beyond it. And Paul is pointing this out. So every philosopher, every scientist, every intellectual, every historian, every journalist, everybody in school, college, and university, everybody at work, wherever you are today, you have a sense of the divine. You know there is a God. And Paul is pointing this out. To the unknown God, what it therefore you worship as unknown, this I proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it, being Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in temples made by man. Nor is he served by human hands as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all mankind life and breath and everything. And he made one man every nation of mankind to live on the face of the earth, having determined the allotted periods and boundaries of them dwelling place. There Paul confronts the Greek society with its many different gods, with its many different ideas. He confronts Greek society with its philosophy of Aristotle and its philosophy of Plato, and he meets it right head on, and he says basically that there is a God of creation. We'll just read it again. The God who made the world and everything in it, being Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in temples made by man. So he's attacking all these various different gods that believe that the gods were physical human beings or characters jumping all over each other and fighting each other. He's saying that God is a spirit. And that's one of the first lessons that we have to learn. Jesus said, you must worship in spirit and in truth. God is spirit. And the Holy Spirit is God. And God is everywhere. He's over everything. He's at all places at all times. That's how great God is. That's the God of this creation. And he's the Lord of heaven and earth. He's the Lord of his creation. He made it. He sustains it with his power. Being Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in temples, nor is he served by human hands. He's attacking religion. He's not served in temples. This God is not a God where you can set up a temple and an idol and then put him as an idol. He's a God of you to worship in your heart by the Holy Spirit. Religion doesn't do anybody any good in the end. Religion is just religion, it's religious practices. What Christianity is about is a real God who you can have a real relationship with, who you can really worship, who you can really adore, and have a one-to-one relationship. Not a piece of stone. People put a stone on the windowsill and they worship that, or put some, you know, Reiki massaging. They can have the massaging and they can have the Reiki stones put on your back, and it's like a pseudo spirituality. God is not like that. God is the Holy Spirit, and we worship in spirit and in truth through God in our hearts by the Holy Spirit. He's not in a stone to worship. You don't worship a statue. You don't worship Mary. You worship God. You worship Christ. And God gave us this life. God gave it. And he made one and every nation, mankind, to live on the face of the earth, having determined the allotted periods and the boundaries of their dwelling place. God created this world, and God is providentially in control of history. All right? That's amazing. You've only got two options. And the skeptics will dance around like ballerinas on fire. You know, it's like ballerinas who are dancing on fire in bare feet. That's what it's like talking to a skeptic when you talk about the origins of the universe. Either the origins of the universe came by chance. How can chance produce the order that we have today? So the skeptic will dance around, oh, wonderfully dance around, like a ballerina on fire, and say, oh no, you can't say it was chance at the beginning of time, because what do you mean by the beginning of time? How do you know what the variables were at the beginning? You don't know. So you don't know if it was chance. Well, as Dawkins said, there's only two conclusions, either it was chance or it was a God who created it. You don't have to be a mathematician, or a great mind to work out, it was either by chance or it was either by God. And chance produces nothing but nothing. It's as simple as that. And so God created this world, and you know that that makes more sense than all your waffle and equivocations that you make. Okay? And he made mankind to live on all the face of the earth, having determined the allotted periods and the boundaries of the dwelling place. History is moving towards God's plan. It might seem to be out of control, but it's not an evolutionary process that is random but not random, which is kind of schizophrenic, really. They put in evolution that evolution is random but not random because they realized how dumb they were by saying that it was random. Now you might say, well, Jay, no, they put it in because they learned more about evolution, you know, about genetics, Jay. They learned a bit more about genetics, so they moved from saying evolution was chance, and then they said evolution was a chance process, but with order. Is that what you think? Well, I got to say to you that you're very, very naive if that's what you think. No, no, no. They brought in this idea that evolution is chance and order because they were saying it was chance, and they knew they hadn't got a leg to stand on. But if you think about it, it's all ultimately chance, ultimately. Because where did the order come from? Where did the order come from? I'll ask you again, where did the order come from? Huh? I can't hear you. Come on, where did the order come from? Hey, I can't hear you. Where did the order come from? Oh, it just popped out of a non-existence. Did it? Intellectually dishonest. Evolution is pure chance, ultimately. Now, I understand that there's mutations and there is mutations and there is natural selection and they go together and they produce whatever you want to produce, okay? I understand that. And you're saying that that is chance and order together. Yeah, I get that, brothers and sisters. I get that. But let me tell you something. Computing, you've got chance and you've got order. Where did the order come from? Simple as that. Tell me where it came from. You don't know where it came from. You don't know how it came from. I'll tell you how it came. It came by chance. And if it came by chance, it's moving forward by chance. And don't try to bog me down with saying this is logical fallacy. No, no, no. Either the universe is moving to a pattern and an order and going somewhere, or it is not. You cannot have a schizophrenic universe that is not going somewhere but going somewhere. That is pure schizophrenia, and you know it. Our position and the Bible's position, the universe is not schizophrenic, it's a going place. It's going and the plan of God, okay? Do you get that? There's a plan for this universe, and there's a plan for your life, and you need to know that plan. The universe is not schizophrenic, okay? If there's order and chance within the universe, there's something above it, and that is the providence and control of God. But if there is no God, if you've got order and chance within a universe, then how on earth did you get the order? And you can't account for that. Okay? Remember that, my friend. Remember that when you go to bed tonight, that you're living in a schizophrenic universe, and you're a schizophrenic thinker because you've not thought it out properly what your position is. I don't care how clever you are, you're believing in a schizophrenic intellectual position that doesn't make sense. And don't try to bog us down with your genetics and your DNA and all your rest. And don't say, oh, the guy's a creationist and you don't know what he's talking about. No, 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 no. Don't you try to bog us down with authority arguments. Don't you try to blind us with science with your DNA and your retroviruses and all your genetic stuff. Don't you bog us down with your equivocations on scientific language saying, what do you mean by species and speciation and all the rest of it? No, no, no. Simple question. And answer the question. Where did order come from? And how can you live in a schizophrenic universe where there's chance and order? How do you account for that? And you can't account for it. And don't say, I don't have to account for it. That's the way it is. No, no, no. That will not do. If there is order and chance within the universe, then where is the universe going? Is it going places? The answer is, from your position, no. Yet you're living in a schizophrenic universe that says there is order and chance with a universe that isn't going anywhere. That is even worse than schizophrenic. That's just crazy. Okay? We believe in an ordered universe because God is in control. And if there's any chance, well, it's in his control anyway. That's how we exist. Alright? So, come on, think, and get your act sorted out. Even though you're clever, you need to repent and trust in the Lord who made you and wants you to be his own. And he made from one man every nation of mankind to live on the face of the earth, having determined allotted periods and the boundaries of their dwelling place, that they should seek God, and the hope that they might feel their way towards him and find him. Yet he is actually not far from one of us. In him we live and move and have our being. Even some of your own poets have said, for we are indeed his offspring. Being then God's offspring, we ought not to think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone, an image formed by the art of imagination of man. The times of ignorance God overlooked, but now he commends all people everywhere to repent, because he has fixed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by whom he is appointed. And this he has given assurance to all men by raising him from the dead. So there is one of the main reasons why I believe in Christianity. Did you hear what he said? Listen to what he said. Listen to what he said. Being then God's offspring, we ought not to think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone or an image formed by the art and imagination of man. The times of ignorance God overlooked, but now he commands, here it is, all people everywhere to repent. Because he has fixed a day in which he will judge the world in righteousness by whom a man he has appointed, and of his he has given assurance to all by raising him from the dead. Listen to me now. Listen to me good. In the history of Western thought, at the Enlightenment, you had Kant and you had all these intellectuals in the Enlightenment. And they were all on about reason, 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 right? But the human race is not just reason, the human race is about morality, right? And there was a split between reason and morality. We began to see the world in a mechanistic universe. That is, all that there was nature. And that really messed us up, that really screwed us up epistemologically. Why? Because when we began to accept evolution, we began to believe that we were people who were just slime, that came from slime, and that we were products of development of animals, and all we are is a higher form of animal. The epistemological nightmare that did is that destroyed half of who we are as human beings. It destroyed our understanding of morality. It completely obliterated our understanding of morality. Because in morality, you cannot get any understanding of what right and wrong is, or a free will. There is no free will in evolution. There is no understanding of what right and wrong is in evolution. But here it says, commands all people everywhere to repent. What that means is, that word there, he commands all men everywhere to repent. Do you know what that implication is? That we live in a moral universe. That it's not just mechanistic. That we are moral creatures who are morally accountable. And so, you can hide away from God with your science. But the ultimate ground of reality is that you're a moral creature and morally accountable in a moral universe. And so therefore you will come before God and you will be judged for your sin. Alright? If you believe in evolution, there's no free will. You're just a product, a biological product of your environment and genetics. If you believe in evolution, there's no right and wrong. It's just your opinion and that's it. Nature doesn't tell you what's right and wrong. From God's perspective, we live in a moral universe. We have the will and capacity to do good or to do evil. And we are accountable. We are not animals. That's one of the foundation reasons why I believe in Christianity, and I don't believe in evolution, and I don't believe in atheism. Because I believe we live in a moral universe. I do not believe we live in a purely mechanistic universe. That is to deny the very reality of who we are as human beings. We are not products of just matter. We are creatures, human beings, who are morally responsible, and we have guilt. We have real culpable guilt. And so therefore we must repent. And every human being knows that. Even you know it. With all your sophistication, even you know it deep down, that you are an accountable human being, and you are accountable for your actions in terms of guilt. All right? The question is, where are you going to get your guilt sorted? You can try and live positive and push your guilt down, but how do you know your guilt's forgiven? Guilt is a reality that needs to be dealt with, and you need to repent of it. You need to repent of your guilt, all right? It's no good saying, I'll go to a counselor and I'll confess my guilt, and then that's it. No, no. You're going to still be guilty. Guilt is guilt until it is dealt with. And the only way it can be dealt with is by God, all right? The times of ignorance of God overlooked, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent. Because he has fixed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by a man whom he has appointed, and of this he has given assurance to all by raising him from the dead. And so that guilt is dealt with by Jesus Christ, who was the God-man. He was a man, but he was God in the flesh. And he came down, and instead of you getting the judgment of God and the punishment of God for your sin, Jesus Christ took your judgment. When he was nailed to the cross and the crown of thorns was upon his head and he was dying on that cross, he was dying on that cross for your sin. He was being punished for your sin. And then he says, the world in righteousness by a man whom he has appointed, of this he has given assurance to all men by raising him from the dead. So there's an assurance that Jesus Christ has risen from the dead. So how do we know that he rose from the dead? Well, number one, you can't understand any facts unless they're in a context. The context of the resurrection is in the context of the Old Testament. The belief in a God and the belief in the Old Testament. And that belief in God and that belief in the Old Testament is the intellectual paradigm for understanding the resurrection. Alright? God as the creator means that we're separated from him. God called Israel and then prophesied that the Messiah would come and die and rise again. The Messiah fits what the Old Testament says the Messiah would be. So we know that Jesus was the person, the Son of God. Now, he fulfills all the types of the Old Testament, and he has the authority of God, and he went to the cross, and he died, and he rose again. And then we have the testimony of the church to that resurrection. And ultimately, it's their testimony, whether it is consistent, whether it is accurate, whether it is believable, that is ultimately where you stand on the resurrection and the testimony of the Holy Spirit to that objective evidence. Because you can believe in something, but it doesn't mean to say you have a relationship with God. You can believe in something intellectual, but it doesn't mean it changes your heart. It's not just pure belief, intellectual, objective belief. It's also belief because the Holy Spirit's opened your eyes. And we believe on the basis of two things, this objective evidence of the life, death, and the resurrection of Jesus, based principally on the testimony of the Old Testament and on the testimony of the early church, and also on the testimony of the Holy Spirit. It's a spiritual as well as an intellectual thing. It's an intellectual as well as a spiritual thing. The two go together. You could talk for hours and hours and hours on a blog show intellectually, but you'll never know God until the Spirit of God opens your eyes. But it's not just the Spirit of God, there is evidence. And you can investigate the disciples' life. You can investigate whether they were honest people. You can investigate whether they're consistent in what they're saying. And if they're consistent and if they're honest, then you have credible evidence to believe that Jesus rose from the dead. All right? And so God has given assurance to all men. Now, when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked and others said, "We will hear you again about this." Some will mock. People will mock. There's always mockers. There were mockers in the time of Noah. They mocked him, but then they got obliterated when the world was destroyed. There were mockers in the time of Jesus when he was on the cross. They mocked him, but they got obliterated in AD 70 when Jerusalem was destroyed. And there are mockers today. People are mocking the Christian faith around the world today. Don't matter if they mock. Don't matter. Don't change the fact that God is on his throne. Don't change the fact that they're going to die. And it don't change the fact that they're going to come before God and they're going to be judged and they'll go to hell if they don't believe in Jesus. So the facts don't change. So you've got to be confident as a Christian and believe that God is in control. And if there are mockers, so what? If people are mocking you at school, grow up. Stop crying if people are taking the mick out of you because you're a Christian at your school or college. Be a man and woman and stand up for your faith and say, "No, I'm not going to be mocked. I'm not going to be put down. I'm going to stand up for my Lord." If they're mocking and taking the mick out of you at church, at your work because you're a Christian, so what? Big deal. They're not pulling your eyes out. They're not chopping your head off. They're not chopping your hands off just because they're mocking you. Don't mean to say that you should give up the faith. "Oh, I'm not going to be a Christian anymore because they're mocking me at work. I'm not going to follow Jesus anymore because they're mocking me at my college or school." For goodness sake, William Tyndale, when he translated the Bible into English, he was captured and he was strangled to death. Latimer and Ridley, the bishops, they were put in the fire and set on fire, and their hands were burning, and they said, one of them said, "Play the man, Master Ridley." I think it was Latimer. "Play the man, Master Ridley, for this day we will light the fire in England that shall never go out." You know, they got burned for their faith. Perpetua, who was a Christian in the early church, she was thrown to the lions. They devoured her. She trusted in the Lord. John Bunyan was put in prison for 12 years, and they trusted in the Lord. You had thousands of ministers in the Great Ejection thrown out. I think it's here. Is it here? No, it's not on there, but you've got thousands of ministers who were thrown out of the church. Thousands of them. And they had no money, and many of them starved. And you're complaining because people are mocking you. There are Christians in Muslim lands. If they get captured, they'll get raped. If you're a Muslim and you become a Christian, you can get raped. You can get killed. It's happening all over these Muslim countries. There are Christian women who were Muslims who became Christians in Egypt, and they're captured and they're raped and they're killed. Sometimes they're killed. And you're complaining because people mock you as a Christian. Are you having a laugh? Are you joking? Are you in your right mind? Are you in your right mind? You need to grow up as a Christian. You need to be strong as a Christian. You need to be a warrior for Jesus. You need to be a man of God. You need to be a woman of God. You're following a noble line of martyrs. And you're complaining because your people are mocking you. Come on, grow up, be strong. This is stupidity. Stop being a namby-pamby Christian, moaning all the time and weeping and getting upset because you got a few people who were mocking you. For goodness sake. When our brothers and sisters in Muslim countries are getting killed because they believe in Jesus. Because we've had martyrs in the past who died for the faith. People like Adonai Judson, who went to Burma and shared the gospel. And he was captured. He was hung upside down for a few years. Upside down on a bamboo stick for a few years. And at the end of it, he had a nervous breakdown. And his wife struggled. Or what about John Nelson, who was a Yorkshire preacher in the time of the George Whitefield revival? And he got captured because he was preaching. And he was put in prison. And his wife was pregnant. And his wife went to go and see her husband at the prison, at the jail. And a gang of people came out and beat her up before she got there. Literally beat her up. And you know what? She lost her baby. And you complain? You complain because people are mocking you? Or John and Charles Wesley, when they went to preach in towns, they preached in Oldham. John Wesley came to preach in Oldham, a town where I'm from. He went to preach in there, and they threw stones at him and stoned him out of the town. You're complaining that people mock you? Get a hard chin. We're soldiers of Jesus Christ. Men and women of the gospel. The day you believed in Jesus Christ was the day that you threw away your life and gave it to God. It's not your life anymore. If God tells you to go to China, or he tells you to go to Afghanistan, or he tells you to go to Pakistan, and you go, and they chop your head off because you preach the gospel, then you go do it. The day you put your faith in Jesus is the day you died. It's the day you died. It's the day you died. And the day Jesus lives in you. And Jesus will have the glory in your life. And if Jesus wants you to serve him and do things for him where you will suffer, then you go and do it. But if you have been mocked, so what? It is a light thing to be mocked. When you start having fingers cut off, your eyes pulled out, your family being raped and killed because you believe in Jesus, then start to say something. But until that happens, get some backbone, sister. Get some backbone, brother. Okay? You're in a war. So put your helmet on, put your armor on, and strap up and get moving. Okay? God bless you. Okay, let's go on. Now, when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked, but others said, "We will hear you again about this." So Paul went out from their midst. Some men joined him and believed, among whom also were Dionysius, the Areopagite, and a woman named Damaris, and others with him. Now that's the beauty of the joy of the gospel. There's always going to be fruit, my friend. Be encouraged. Be encouraged if you're serving the Lord. Wherever you are today, be encouraged. There's always going to be fruit. Yes, there is. There's always going to be fruit. The Lord says, look into the harvest. They're ripe for harvest. Okay? There's always going to be fruit. You remember the parable of the sower? The seed is put out on the farm. Some seed falls on bad soil. Some seed is pecked by the birds. Some seed falls on the thorns. But some seed bears fruit. It goes into the ground and it grows and it bears fruit. My friend, you keep sowing the seed of the Word of God and there will be fruit. Yes, there'll be fruit in your ministry. It might be you're sowing the seed in a person that it seems to be pointless. But it will not be pointless. There will be fruit wherever you're sowing the seed. Keep sowing the seed in the Sunday school. Keep sowing the seed in the youth worker. in the youth work. Keep sowing the seed in the church. Keep sowing the seed in your university and college. Or though hell may rage against you. And they are raging on the university campuses. The atheists are like, they're like devils dancing on the coals of fire. They are out to get the Christians on the university campuses, some of these militant atheists. And we have these do-gooder feminists and these do-gooder gay rights activists all over the universities at the moment, and they're hell-bent on squashing and dampening the evangelical witness on the universities around the UK and around America today. They are hell-bent in silencing the Christian faith because they don't like what you stand for, that you call people to repent. They are not, they call you homophobic, but they are Christophobic. They hate Christ with a passion because they don't like his message of repentance. But even in the midst of that, you got to sow the seed. You keep sowing it. Don't matter what they say. They're not God. The feminists aren't God. The gay rights activists aren't God. God is God. And you're called of God. And you get sowing the seed of the word of God on your university campus. You organize debates with the Muslims and the skeptics. You organize discussion groups with the gay rights activists. And get that word of God into them. And believe in the power of the word of God to change their lives. Don't be put off by these people. Don't be put off by the politically correct governments that we're getting in the UK and in America, who are pandering to these lefties all the time. Don't, and the political right have moved over to the left in morality. Don't back down from it. Keep sowing the word of God. You keep sowing it. You sow the word of God. That's what we got to do. We got to keep sowing it. We just sow the seed and God blesses it. We sow it in the university. We sow it in the media. We sow it on the internet. We sow it everywhere where we can. We sow the word of God. And we let God do the work. And he will do his work. And he will bring his people home. And he will save them. Don't be put off by the opposition. Don't be put off and cow down at this time, because that's what's happening at the moment. Our secular culture is trying to browbeat us into submission, to trying to stop us from preaching the gospel, trying to stop us to say what sin is and to say what sin isn't. No, no. We don't care what the secularists think. We don't care what they think. We care what God thinks, and we do what God says. And if God says something's sin, we'll say it's sin. And if God says something's right, we'll say it's right. Okay? We won't goad people. We won't try to pick on people. But we will tell people the way it is, what God says. Okay? At the end of the day, my friend, sow the seed of the word of God. Because this is life. This is hope. This is where it's at. This is what it's all about. It's all about knowing God as your Father, through Jesus Christ, our Savior. And so sow the seed. There'll always be fruit. Even the most implacable enemy may be converted at your serving the Lord. The greatest need in the Western Church today is for young people to start to take seriously the Great Commission of sowing the seed. You, as young people, need now to take up the cudgels for Christ and begin to turn the tide against these militant atheists, against these people who are trying to bring in a new morality that is not of God, against these politically correct governments. You as young people need to take the rear guard action and begin to preach and teach the word of God in your universities and be as bold as brass. You need to do it in your school, in your college, in your university. And now let me tell you something. You need to be 100% determined, because they will try to kick it out of you, my friend. They will try to break you. They will try to force you not to do it. But you got to keep sowing that seed. You got to keep sowing that word of God. Okay? You got to make up your mind that you're more determined than the atheist You're more determined than a Muslim. You're more determined than a gay rights activist, than the feminist, than the leftist, than the political correctist, or whoever they are. You got to be more determined than them, because you know that Jesus Christ is the savior of the world, and if they don't turn to Jesus, they're going to be lost for eternity, and you got to be determined to save their souls, and you got to be strong in the sowing of the seed, young person. And you use creative ways. You pray about it. You say, Lord, how do you want me to reach my generation? It might be you start a meal in your college and university once a week and invite everybody to come and give a talk. It might be you do an Alpha course or a Christianity Explore course. It might be any other way. It might be debates, organizing debates between the faculty or the professors, or and inviting professors in. I don't know what it is. It might be street evangelism. It might be rapping. I don't know. You've got to find out where your people are at, where you're at. If you're a young person on a housing estate, then you use rapping if you want to use rapping. I don't know what the best way is to reach your people, but you'll have an idea. God will give you the idea, and when he gives you the idea, you go and sow. I don't care if there's a gang in New York that doesn't want you to preach the word of God. You go and preach it, and you ignore that gang. If they tell you you can't preach in that area, you go and preach in that area. You preach. Don't ignore them. Don't matter what they say, you go preach. You don't let no gang stop you from preaching the gospel. You don't let nobody intimidate you from preaching the gospel, for sharing the gospel. Okay? You keep sowing that seed, because there's going to be blessing. God is going to save people through your work. As a pastor, as a preacher, and you're getting tired of preaching the word of God, you're getting tired of proclaiming the gospel, my friend, you're doing the right thing if you're sowing the word of God. If you're sowing the word of God, you're doing the right thing. Paul got immediate results. You might not see immediate results. It might take time. It might take time before people can come to know the Lord Jesus Christ. But they'll come if you keep sowing the seed. Now, we're coming to an end here. But we've looked at the resurrection of Christ in the preaching of the Word of God, in the evangelism, and in pastoral care. The cross and the resurrection has to be central. And so the question is, in our gospel preaching, do we make the resurrection a center of our preaching? I think if we did, you'd see powerful results. Do we make our pastoral care center around the resurrection? For example, if someone is addicted to pornography, if someone is addicted to sex, if someone is addicted to drugs, how are you going to get them off the drugs? How are you going to get them off the sex? How are you going to get them off the porn? I tell you, you get them to understand the resurrection and what's happened to them when they believe in Jesus, that they become a new creature in Christ. A new dispensation has come in Jesus Christ. That's what you do. Preach the resurrection. Okay. Well, we've gone on quite a bit. And I'm very, very tired. I preached, like I said, 4 hours yesterday. I shouldn't be preaching today. But I hope you found that a blessing and an encouragement. And I'm going to close in prayer. And I put a bit of that music on, and we'll close in prayer. See if anybody's left any messages. And if there's anybody, any messages. Again, Mark, love to you and to your dear wife. Louis Fayad, Jason, don't complain about mocking you all the time. Louis, I hope you're okay, mate. Hope your university studies are doing okay. It's not about the mocking. I can take mocking. What I don't like, Louis, is people ganging up on other people. It's skeptics on their shows, getting Christians apologist on and sneering and sniggering and then trying to savage a Christian apologist. That's what I complain about, Lewis, okay? It's called civilization, bro. Just show a bit of civilization, and I'll be okay, alright? So that's to you, and to you, Mark. Love to your wife, and your dear brother in Christ, and hope you're okay, mate. And I hope we can meet up soon. I'll do a series for you in the next few days on Anglican theologians. I'm also going to be doing on Catholic theologians as well. So it'd be good. I'll see what you have to say about that, and that you'd enjoy that. And to you, Lewis, hope your studies are doing okay, mate. And it's nice to see you around, and hope everything's okay. All right. So love to everybody. Let's put that song on, and I'm going to close in prayer.
Wake up, Lord.
Hope Montana.
Like the woman at the well, I was seeking.
Hallelujah.
For things that could not satisfy.
Woo-hoo.
And then I heard my Savior speaking.
Yes.
Draw from my well that never shall run dry. Fill my cup, Lord. I lift it up, Lord. Pull me out this thirsting of my soul. Bread of heaven, feed me till I want no more. Fill my cup, fill it up and make me
prayer. Things to watch out for. Like I said, I'll be uploading stuff on evolution in the next few days of different people's lectures and talks, but also I'll be uploading quite a bit of Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones, one of my favorite preachers. So I am delighted, absolutely delighted to be able to put Dr. Martin Lloyd-Jones. I'm going to be delighted to put his preachings and preaching on the channel, and that's going to be absolutely wonderful. So I'm really chuffed about that. And that's it, really. I'm going to close in prayer. And so we'll try and do a few on for Anglican theologians and Catholic theologians in the next few days if I do stuff like that. We'll do some Bible teaching in the future, and don't forget the debate that I'm going to try and organize. I've not contacted anybody yet, but I will be on that and contact them. There's a good couple of scientists who are in Australia, and I'm going to see if I can get hold of them and see if they'll come, and from the creationist side. I don't know if it'll happen, but we'll see. So, God bless you all. Love to everybody. And trust in Jesus. Trust in the Lord. Okay, let's close in prayer. Lord Jesus Christ, we thank you for your amazing love. We thank you that you are indeed our God, that we're saved by grace and nothing of ourselves, that you died at Calvary and you gave all for us. And we confess every sin to you today, Lord. We pray that you would wash us clean under the blood of the Lamb. We pray for those who do not know you today, who have heard these words. We pray for each one that they would come to know you as Lord and Savior. May they come to trust you, Lord. May they come to know you as Lord and Savior. May they become to believe in you. May they know that you are their Lord today. And I pray for all of us who do know you today. May we be strong in you today. Fill us with your Holy Spirit. Protect us from the attacks of the evil one. And help us to draw close to you. May God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and these three are one, be with you all. Amen. 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 I'm going to go in a second. And this is Hope Montana. You can get this song, full song, on Brian Dunn, D-U-N-N-E.
I was seeking for things that could not satisfy, and then I heard my Savior speaking, draw from my well that never shall run dry. Fill my cup, Lord, I lift it up, Lord. Come and quench this thirsting of my soul. Bread of heaven, feed me till I want no more.
Folks, God bless you.